WXRK, New York, 92.3 K-Rock. Great rock. K-Rock. Period.
The latest rage for kids is driving parents and entire neighborhoods crazy.
The Lazlow Show.
There are places on Long Island where men go to hook up with other men. Mm. The Field 6 parking lot at Jones Beach.
I was just there yesterday morning at 6 o'clock in the morning. That's amazing.
Big Wayne.
A rest stop near exit 52 on the Long Island.
Oh, I know that one. Hold on. That's called Pickle Park.
And
if you need to get around New York City, a scooter is the way to go.
Producer Reed Tucker.
You know what? I'm gonna bring in my registration papers, because technically, according to the state of New York, it is a motorcycle.
A motorcycle that's not, that can't go over 35 miles an hour.
A motorcycle with streamers on the handlebars.
Big Daddy. The donation to the Night and Eagle Pizza Fund.
And what's that?
That's a donation for pizza and beer for Negro.
Oh, yeah!
The Lazlow Show.
Lazlow Show, episode 12, the international episode. Sitting in for producer Reed is a British writer, comedian, and homophobe, neurotic, Gaylord Menzies. We have Drew Curtis of Fark.com coming in on the show. Comedian Christian Finnegan sitting in during the 9 o'clock hour. We'll have some tech news, some interview stuff coming out, new tech junk for the holidays. Story of Wayne, who this weekend was trying to grab the ass of a girl in a wheelchair. And to start this week's episode, we're going to go with a tune from Go Home Productions. It's MASH's Prodigy with one of my favorite bands, the Osmonds. It's Baby's Got a Crazy Horse.
We'll be right back.
93K Rock, it is the Lazlow Show, episode 12. And as I... Did you just belch?
Not me.
Must have been you.
I think it was Wayne.
It wasn't me.
Reed Tucker is visiting his family in Virginia. He's normally the producer, so we had to have somebody sit in. A longtime friend of Wayne and I's, Gaylord Menzies. You're a British writer, comedian. We've got a lot of stories that involve England and other countries. We thought maybe you could help out.
I'll do my best.
And we have to start off, Wayne, by talking about the website. Every episode of the show is archived online at the website. We had a little bit of a meltdown.
Seems to be getting larger than what you can offer.
Correct.
Not for the first time.
In basically 10 days, we doubled the amount of bandwidth and downloads that are acceptable on the current financial plan, and I was contacted by Earthlink that in the course of 4 days, we had racked up additional bandwidth fees of about $350 to $400. The website went dark this weekend as we moved to a new server that hopefully will not melt down. Because, let me backpedal a little bit. A couple of Wayne's romantic moments where he talks about relationship things in the past were played on Opie and Anthony.
Yeah. My national acclaim.
And his national acclaim. Even on the message boards, he's known as Baby Arm Bob.
which I'm not happy with because I'm Big Wayne and I want to be Baby Arm Bob. That might be another character.
Because he had a little fetish regarding a girl that had a deformed arm.
Still do.
Have you talked to her? Have you told her that you're talking about her on the radio?
No, but it's still a fantasy. It still comes through.
So we got the website sorted out. It is lazlow.com. You can download past episodes. You can see pictures of Wayne trying to grab the waitress at Friday's.
Yeah. Hey, Maria.
Talking about her big ass.
was she the one in the wheelchair?
No.
Oh, no, no. No,
we'll get to that one.
Okay, I can't wait.
We'll get to that story. That was
no, just so you feel you. Hey, Marie is the barmaid down at TGI Fridays. When we close the show, we go down there and bang back a couple before the train.
So we might be meeting her later.
Yes, you're more than welcome to come on down.
Fantastic.
And Gaylord being single, it just might be the opportunity to hook him up.
Well, I think you need to get a better name besides Gaylord. I mean, to meet women.
What's wrong with Gaylord, Lazlow?
It's
an old family name. Is Lazlow a better name? Is that what you're trying to say?
No.
Okay.
So I was talking.
Prejudiced?
No, I'm not prejudiced. No, I leave that to the people down south. We actually have some clips on tonight's show of some amazing things that were said by the people down there in the south. We should call them Southerners. We also have some interesting talk radio segments that went on this week. Some information about a TV that's mounted in a monkey. Some more Japanese rap coming up on this show. And as I said, we've been playing these Japanese rap tunes that are hysterical because when you translate what they're actually saying,
they shouldn't be played on this radio station.
No, not that. It's just that.
Oh, no, not that.
No, they're rapping about each other's cell phones. Your cell phone is so weak. Your cell phone don't take a text message.
You know what the German is for cell phone?
Handy, right?
Yeah, hast du ein Handy? Have you got a cell phone?
They call it a handy. That is, why don't they call
what
it
do
a...
You call, what do you think when I say the word handy, Lazlow?
I think
massage parlor.
I think maybe I might be pleasuring somebody.
Exactly.
I think glory hole, actually, is what I think.
Do you do a lot of glory holes?
Not since Oklahoma, actually.
But in Oklahoma, you have done glory hole.
No, I have not done glory hole.
Well, you just said not since I was back in Oklahoma.
I was being facetious. Once.
Oh, okay. Because I'm willing to give it a try.
For the show?
For the show.
For the good of the show.
I'm willing to take one to the head.
Do they have any glory holes left in New York after Giuliani?
They've got to.
Sure. There's got to be some left, haven't
there? There's
got
to be some underground ones, without a doubt.
If anyone knows, Lazlow.com. Send the information in, please.
Oh, you're good, Gaylord.
That name.
You gotta
it's an
love
old
just,
English family name.
You gotta love just saying it, Gaylord.
You have the name, Gay is in your name.
Like, any nicknames
what's
as
wrong,
a kid?
What's wrong with that?
Any nicknames as a kid?
No. You don't need a nickname if that's your name.
So this week I was doing some research for my nationally syndicated radio tech thing, and I came across a UK-related item. In other countries, their mobile phones are far more advanced than ours for some reason. They're sending videos back and forth to each other. They've been doing this for years. And in England, there's this new service now called CelebrityMessages.com, where if you don't want to say something, you can basically pay money and send a message from a celebrity, you know, saying, I really like you, or whatever. The celebrity doesn't actually say your name. They're stock messages. But I was going through the list, and there's some celebrities there I've never heard of, because some of them are obviously, whatever, limeys. And but there was one I noticed, Boy George. You can actually, if you're a guy, you can enter a girl's mobile phone number, and this video will pop up on her phone.
Hello, bit of bad news, really. Your boyfriend wants to end the relationship. I suggest watching Fatal Attraction, getting very drunk, and seeking revenge. And remember, revenge is a dish best served cold.
Is Boy George a bigger phenom over there than he is here, or?
I think Boy George is just desperate for money.
Oh, I actually met him when I worked at LIR.
Not at the Glory Hole.
No, I was going to. I heard Karma Chameleon coming out that little speaker.
It was a real Karma Chameleon.
There's if you're a girl, I guess you can pay for Melanie B. Is that her name?
From the Spice Girls.
Yeah,
again, a career in massive nosedive.
Hiya, love. It's me, Melanie B, the bearer of news. Good news is you had a lot of fun while it lasted. Bad news is it's over. You've been chucked. You are officially single. Depressing. Yeah. Scary. Yeah. Internet dating for you only.
Internet dame.
Sorry.
Internet dame for you only. Is that how, what do you say instead of like online porn? You say internet dame?
I don't know. I think she meant dating, but she's got a slight speech impediment.
Does she?
Well, evidently. She can't talk properly.
Or sing properly, for that matter.
No, I don't think she did much singing.
But I just thought, you know, what a great... And by the way, these messages, if you want, you know, Melanie B to help you break up or whatever, and this video to pop up on their phone, it's like $7 to $10. For one play.
Yeah, but if you got them in person, it'd be $100,000. So it's cheap.
Another one from Boy George. If you're a guy breaking up with a girl.
Hello, message from your boyfriend. He wants to end the relationship, but that's quite good news because you can find someone with a decent-sized penis now to satisfy you.
Celebrity culture gone insane.
It really
when
is.
When you actually can't talk to someone anymore apart from through the medium of a celebrity.
Right.
I always thought the best part of dumping them was dumping them. Face to face, you get to say it yourself. Why would I want that?
Like, what?
You like to see a girl cry, Wayne.
Well, I don't know about like to see her cry.
Yeah,
but,
on last week's episode, but, you know, Wayne informed us that he used to go by the high schools when he was in his 20s. He'd go by high schools on his motorcycle and pick up chicks and then ask them to pay for gas.
That was that was called online dating back then. You get online, I take you for a ride, we're dating.
Before the internet, we had high schools.
Exactly.
It was a great high school.
I don't know where it's still in effect today. There ain't a guy that's in my business that doesn't know where high schools are.
Well,
you're out for lunch, you're going carpenter. Past Seaford High School.
Hold on a second. So you're a carpenter.
Not just all the trades, electricians, AC guys.
And they go by Seaford High School. What do you do?
Well, not just Seaford. I just happen to know.
Any high school you might go to.
Yeah, any neighborhood you're in, I guarantee the guys know where the high schools
are. And
what
do they do at the high school?
They just like to troll by.
And do what?
Just Google. Yeah, yell out obscenities. You know. Mostly Google, though. Not too many have the...
They're not worried about the statutory rape charge.
There's no, because there's no rape going on. It's
voluntary.
Mentally, there is. Physically, no.
There's this band I never heard of, but they have a video that you can send. Say you have a one-night stand with a girl, and she was amazing, and you want to really hit it home that last night was great. You know, maybe we'll get together and do it again. You can send her a video from this band called on her. It'll arrive on her mobile phone. It's from Goldie Looking Chain. You ever heard of them? They're a British band.
They're a Welsh. Now, if you know Welsh, it's a place where most people are inbred, have no thumbs, kind of
like Oklahoma.
Pretty similar.
It's like the Oklahoma of England.
The Oklahoma of England. Used to have a lot of coal mines there. They all got shut down. So now the people just do a lot of stealings, you know, wearing a lot of gold chains, a lot of drugs, a lot of being, you know, quite inbred. We always joke they don't have thumbs and they like to have intimate relations with sheep. Goldie Looking Chain are probably the world's only Welsh rap act, but they are quite funny.
Well, okay. There's a video that you can send to a girl that you had a a one-night stand with, and this will arrive on our mobile phone.
Hello! We are called...
Goldie Looking Chain.
And we got... That's right. We got a message from a man you had sex with when you were drunk, and he was so impressed by your naked form that he's got to tell you he loves you. He loves you so much that he wants to get on top of you again and sweat, probably tonight. That's the deal. Get your clothes off, loves.
Love.
He loves you.
It's love.
Love.
He loves you.
What does that cost?
Like $7-$8 to send
70 or
no,
seven.
$7 to $8 to send these videos from a celebrity to one of your friends. They also have obviously just like audio messages that will arrive in their inbox and stuff like that, and text messages, which I don't understand. Now
maybe for bandwidth, I could do a couple of those, and we could dump a couple chicks. You don't think so? Raise a couple dollars.
You think that somebody would actually want to, like, if they wanted to break up with somebody, they would have Big Wayne say...
I think I could do it in a relatively nice manner.
Okay, well, give me one.
I would have to know the scenario, how long they're together,
no.
You know.
Oh, you want to do personalized messages.
Sure,
that,
you know,
that
how
costs
long...
costs a lot more.
How long have they been together, you know, what's the deal?
Considering this is coming from a guy who took a chick to get an abortion and then took her home from the clinic and banged her again and got her pregnant again.
But yep.
There was actually more to the story I found out on the train coming home with you were telling me that this it was the babysitting thing.
The babysitting thing.
Yeah, you said that the same chick, you were like babysitting some kids over at her house.
Oh yeah, she had a her brother-in-law was a big
romantic moments with Big Wayne.
Her brother-in-law was a big coke dealer down in Park Slope, Brooklyn. And you know, so him and his old lady could get out of the house. He would ask, you know, his sister-in-law, which was the girl I was dating who had the abortion, if we'd watch the kids, you know. And the kids went to bed, and, you know, there was an eight ball on the coffee table, and, you know, just all night long partying, you know, until they came home, which was usually like Monday. It's like, you're going to watch the kids for 3 hours, you know, on Saturday night from like 8 to 12. You're figuring, all right, I'm out of here. Next thing you know, it's Monday morning.
And let me get this straight. So your payment to babysit was an eight ball of cocaine.
Or whatever. It was just unlimited supply. You just, as long as you stayed with the kids. I'm going to tell you, now that I think about it, I don't remember the kids even being there. I got to honestly say, we probably pawned them off on somebody else for a $25 piece. Hey, watch these kids for a night. We'll be back soon.
Here's a few rails. See if you can watch these kids.
Yep.
Oh, my Lord.
I forgot that last week already. See, that's good. I forgot that I told you about it.
It was happy memories.
Yeah.
He was telling me about this.
It was good times.
He was telling me about this on the train, and I said... And so, well, what about the kids? He's like, oh, you know, we'd go off in the room, do some rails, we'd be banging, and, you know, we wouldn't see the kids for 20 hours. Kids could be in there setting their hair.
How old were the kids?
I think there was like a 3 and a 5 or 6 year old. Although these kids needed attention come AM. I remember that, but I wasn't giving it to them.
I think now these kids will be deep in therapy.
Suddenly, suddenly something out of Train spot, and there's a dead baby crawling across the ceiling. Wayne's coming down off of a huge coke bench.
But I, as I recall, I got to say, I've done a lot of coke in my days and paid very little for it. Babysitting paid
the American
good.
Dream.
Babysitting paid real good back in the early 80s. And I still had a bank account come Monday morning.
Right.
Because, you know, that would be the oldest thing here. You got paid on Friday, and you'd have, you know, the ATM card, and, you know, you'd start on Friday night at 9 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning, you'd see when you got your bank statement was the first time you went to the ATM. Then it was 3 o'clock. Then it was 6 o'clock, and it just went periodically till there were zeros in the account.
And was that every weekend?
Pretty, oh, for a lot, you know, and then all of a sudden you'd get this grip, oh, I just, that's 3 weekends in a row I did that, I got to do something else. So then I started freebasing. Which gets even more expensive, but you don't realize it.
Remember, kids, drugs are bad.
If you could see Wayne now, you'd know how. How about?
I had good recovery.
Yeah, if you want to see a picture of the man that is saying these awful things, we actually have pictures of people from the show on lazlow.com, except for Gaylord. We will get a picture of him up at some point.
Definitely.
But I actually played this for Gaylord over the phone this week when I was putting together some show prep. And besides, you know, the normal messages that you would send to somebody's phone from a celebrity saying, I really like you or I want to break up, sometimes you are too scared a person might be too scared to tell their parents their real sexual preference. So,
Gaylord's issue.
Be nice, dude. He's sitting in for Reed. Otherwise, it'd just be you and
Keith. I think Reed's got issues too.
It's not my issue, Wayne.
It's not.
Not my main issue. It's one of many issues.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll get to your Coke stories later. I've heard many of your Coke stories. So let's say that you wanted to tell your parents that you're gay. Well, you can go on this service, pay like $7-8, and your mom gets a video from Boy George.
Hello, Mom and Dad. Sit down. I'm channeling a message from your son. Take a deep breath and relax. I'm a homosexual! I like men! Get over it.
Can you imagine your mom like, oh, look at this. It's a little video message from my son.
Oh, it's George, Boy George. I knew him in the 80s.
And the worst thing is now you're having a transvestite inform you that your son is gay. But just so that, you know, Boy George is really whoring himself out. I guess if you're a lesbian and you're too scared to tell your parents or they haven't noticed that you haven't shaved your legs in ages.
Hello, Mum. I think you should sit down for this. I got a message from your daughter. She wants me to let you know that she's a lesbian. But don't worry, she isn't growing a beard.
Is there nothing this man won't do for money?
You know, the last album he put out, he actually came to the radio station that I used to work at. And, I mean, we were all sort of excited to meet the guy, but...
Were you very excited?
I was slightly excited.
Okay. That's
I mean, but, you know...
That's your era, though, too. Well, you probably were like a Boy George.
Yeah. I had a 45.
Just a 45?
I had a 45.
What's a 45?
A record.
Okay.
What do you have in England?
A single.
You have a record in England.
Okay. Well, there's a 40... It's a...
Okay. Did you sit in it with him?
Huh? Yeah, I sat in the studio with him, but you could tell that he'd been doing heroin for a long time. I mean... The drugs had taken hold.
Did he ever try and hit on you or anything?
No.
Because you're known to have guys hit on you.
It is true.
Take that as a compliment, in a sort of a way.
Yeah, sure.
Good.
Sure.
Yeah. I know you do.
Afterwards, you feel a bit like a peacock. Walking around all fluff feathers.
So, you know what? We're going to get to this right away. This weekend, we went to this benefit for Long Beach, Mississippi, because we live in Long Beach, New York.
Yes.
And
they've got the same name.
And Laz rubs elbows with, like, all the politicians, all the bigwigs. I'm standing there with him. I'm, like, the low-life friend, you know, just kind of in his shadows. He's like, this is city council so-and-so, and this is the senator. And I'm like, hey, there, nice to meet you.
Right. Meanwhile, Wayne's baked. He's got a huge plate full of food he's shoving in his face, and he's guzzling beer. He's got this dreadlock beard down his way. He's like, burp, hey, nice to meet you.
This one guy that was a city council, and I'm trying to say to him, I think I met your daughter about 2 weeks ago. She's 21 years old. I look at this guy, and I realize he's only 30 years old and his wife's pregnant.
She wasn't too happy. She's like, what are you talking about? But you know how there'll be those people, they're not really in wheelchairs anymore. They're in those sort of
scooters. That's right. Now I remember.
God, you were so hammered. And so I'm talking, last week was the drunk episode. That was, by the way, I got a call from Cousin Eddie. He was so...
inebriated?
No, he was so freaked out that we were talking about him on last week's show. He went and downloaded it.
And he couldn't comment.
He was listening to it at 4 in the morning and taking notes. He called me the next morning. He's like, I listened to your show where you were making fun of me because I was drunk when I called into your show, but I was too drunk to remember listening to the show. I'm like, oh, you're a mess. But this woman goes by on this little scooter or whatever, and I feel something brush against my ass.
Yeah.
And so I say... Hey, he was grabbing my ass, right? And I look back, and it's a woman in a wheelchair, whatever. And I'm like, whoopsie, hi, hello, disabled person. And so she...
A little politically correct moment there for
right.
you.
Right. And so then we're, after the whole thing, we're out in the parking lot. We're heading to the car. And she goes by, and she's like, there's the guy that thought I was grabbing his ass, right? Now, Wayne at this point is even more inebriated and goofed up. And he screams at her, I'm going to come grab your ass. And he starts after her. And this little, I've never seen one of those
she
scooters.
She twisted this throttle. She had to weigh about 250 pounds. I couldn't keep up with her.
He was chasing her in the parking lot. I'm telling you, I think she had a nitrous button on
she
this
might
little.
Have. That thing took off.
I've never seen one of those. I was waiting for her to hit a pebble and flip over.
But she had a great sense of humor. She did it that.
Well, yeah, I mean, you're chasing her through a dark parking
lot. I was probably yelling obscenities at her at that point, too, but...
How did it end?
That was it. She smoked me. That was it. I couldn't even make out the license plate. It took off so fast.
Yeah, it was a bit of...
You know, literally, those things, you know, they're putting. They're like... And the neighborhood we live in, there seems to be a tremendous amount of them that... You see those people, they actually use them on Park Avenue, and they expect you to yield when you're in your car, you know? And I'm like, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
you're handicapped, but you can't stop three lanes of moving traffic because you need to cross the street.
How do you really feel about handicapped people, Wayne?
I love them all.
This is the Lazlow Show. Coming up, like I said, we've got Christian Finnegan, comedian. We've got Drew Curtis of Fark.com is coming on. Reed is supposed to be landing at any moment, between now and 7, I believe.
And we're going to get a report about where he's at, too.
And hopefully he'll be on his...
we're going to get like the Santa Claus map on New Year's Eve. You know, like on the news, they tell you where Santa Claus is at like 11 o'clock. He's over Poland somewhere.
Dude, did you see there was a Polish parade? Did you see there was a Polish parade after we finished? Before we came into the studio, there was a Polish parade.
Yes.
There was a traffic jam. And I'm sorry, the first thing that went through my mind, it was like, of course, the Polish parade, like people are turning the wrong direction down the street. Terrible. I was like, don't be a stereotype, people. Let's go. This is the Lazlow Show.
Flight 50.
923 K-Rock. It is the Lazlow Show. One of the nice fade out there on the GNR. We just got a call from some dude. He listened to that show that we did about the TV Be Gone, little handheld thing where you can, it's got the off codes for all the televisions.
Yep.
Said he got one and he's been going into bars. And
sounded like he was out in a bar, the Nutty Irishman out there in Farmingdale, I believe it is.
Yeah, so he said he's like turning TVs off and they can't figure out what's wrong with the television.
Yeah, so I sent him into some biker bars. He's like, I don't want to get my butt kicked.
It's a very good impression, Wayne. So last week we contributed some stuff from this show to the Opie and Anthony auction they had. They raised like $50,000 and there was like some t-shirts. Some Radio Lazlow hats, some stickers and stuff, and some other signed game stuff. And somebody paid $202 for it.
Yeah.
And it's all going to the Red Cross for Hurricane Katrina.
It's probably your mother. You probably told your mother about it. She bought it back.
If my mother's eBay screen name is Tater Nut, then...
Tater Nut. Hey, that could be her. That sounds like a Southern woman.
You think
so? Tater Nut. She loves those potatoes.
Speaking of the show, like I said, we've had literally tens of thousands of people hitting the website and downloading past episodes. And we had somebody, I guess, here in the New York area, we made, I guess, a joke about Satanists last week.
There's nothing funny about the devil, Lazlow.
And I forgot to mention, sitting in for the useless producer, Reed Tucker, is Gaylord Menzies from England. And she sent this email. She says, hi, my name is Diana. I've been listening to your show. Last week you said something about Satanists, but I can tell you we're not all bad. I don't sacrifice anything. And then she says, I think you should play some Marilyn Manson. And so I emailed her back because, you know, when you get an email from a Satanist, you got to respond. It's bad form. Mm.
What did you say to her?
I said, you better find Jesus. I said,
he's here to acid.
What?
He's here to acid. You go find Jesus.
Everybody finds Jesus in a different way. So I emailed her back and I said, really, you don't sacrifice anything. I said, so there's a lot of, you know, you and your Satanist buddies get together and listen to the Lazlow Show. It says, well, everybody thinks that we should sacrifice something or other, but it's not necessary. Really, I mean, I've only given him what he really wants, so I'm guessing he's satisfied.
How does she know what the devil really, really wants?
I suppose... I don't know.
What did she sacrifice? I mean? You make it sound like
when
she...
When she's saying she's not all bad, well, she can't be good. So what is she, kind of average?
I don't know. And then she says, did you know that 3 a.m. is the witching hour? That's the time that demons are able to hang around. I guess it's a union thing, and the demons are...
Double time.
we can't do 4 a.m.
Listen, I'm a demon. I'm really quite busy running the 700 Club. She says, Halloween is kind of dangerous because some fellow Satanists do sacrifice people. So you have to know what you're doing.
Kind of dangerous.
She says that the Satanists like to go to Coney Island.
Mm.
Maybe win each other some
masochists as well.
Prizes, you know. What's the difference?
Why Coney Island?
Because, I don't know, it's kind of dilapidated. They like to win each other prizes, throwing, you know, things at the balloons.
I don't know. Neighborhood scares me.
Yeah?
Yeah. It's not a high Caucasian neighborhood.
A lot of red people with horns coming out of their head.
At 3 a.m. there is.
Made it 40 minutes into the show before there was something.
And I don't care what part of New York City, and it's like that everywhere. There's one side of the street, there's white people are welcome, and then there's one side of the street, white people ain't welcome.
Land of the free.
Exactly.
Do you have these problems in England?
Most definitely.
Yeah, but more around the way you speak rather than what you look like.
What do you mean? Oh, really?
You've got a different accent to someone, they want to kick your head in.
Really?
Yeah, it's if you support a different football team. Thing about England is there's less guns, so conversely, in some ways, there's more violence. Because people are much more up for just smashing your face in, and that being kind of more like an act of brotherly love in some way, as opposed to someone pulling out a gun and shooting your head off, which no one could convince you was brotherly love.
Have you ever been to a full-on soccer riot?
Not a full-on. I've seen little people kind of picking up bottles and throwing them at each other and smashing their heads into the curb, but it wasn't very full-on.
What's the worst?
That's pretty full on. Okay, Gaylord, just so you know.
Just a gentle little.
What is the.
I come from a neighborhood where bottles were thrown. When you got everyone, it's pretty violent.
What is the worst soccer riot that's gone on over there? Wasn't there one that like 100 people died or something?
I don't think people died. Too many people died in the actual riots. They were more in stadium collapsing. You know, that was more of a cheap stadium and a
oh, that's right.
Constructionists cutting corners and less about people actually rioting.
They were all jumping up and down.
Well, a lot of them were crushed against fences that the government insisted they had in place to stop the rioters. So, yet again, it's Big Daddy government doing us all a favor.
Usually we ignore the Brits, but in the New York Times, they have an article in here. Evidently, there's a dude over there causing a little problem. He won the
Tony Blair.
he won the lottery. His name is Michael Carroll.
Oh, the rapist.
The rapist. They didn't put that in this article.
Oh, no, there's another guy who won the lottery who's a rapist, who's just been let out of prison. He won about $14, $15 million on the lottery. And the newspaper's up in arms because on the one hand, this man should be in prison. On the other hand, he's a multimillionaire.
Yeah, but if he did his time, he's a multimillionaire who did his time.
Exactly. But it seems like he maybe has been... He's done his time, but they're suggesting he isn't fully reformed. So some of the things he's ordering are not things that you might want.
Yeah, but the difference is once you have that kind of dough, then you can buy yourself out of a conviction. This guy's name is Michael Carroll in Swaffham, England.
Never heard of it.
Come on, dude. The country's about the size of Kentucky. You haven't heard of it? His name's Lotto Lout. He won $15 million American and showed up to collect his prize while wearing a police-issued electronic ankle bracelet. Before he won the lottery, he was a nuisance, said a guy. He decided to carry on being a nuisance. Since he won the lottery, he has appeared in court 30 times in the last 3 years. He has spent 3 months of that time in jail on drug charges, paid thousands of dollars in fines for vandalism, and been evicted from several hotels because he likes to go in there and swing from the chandeliers and rip them out of the ceiling. He has 240 hours of community service because he was driving around liquored up, shooting ball bearings through car and shop windows with a wrist rocket.
A slingshot.
Yeah, baby. In the middle of the night. In the middle of the night, he has demolition derbies on his land. This is what I would do if I won the lottery. You know, people are like, oh, I'm not going to change. I'm like, I'm going to annoy everybody in this neighborhood because you're all annoying to me.
Because you can.
And they've asked him to clean up the front yard of his house, which is covered with tires, beer cans, food wrappers, old furniture, and half-smashed up cars from the demolition derbies. See, I always imagine Brits to be really sophisticated. I mean, you sound sophisticated. You we came from your country.
You ran away so you could be more right-wing over here.
No, we came over here so we could be free from your persecutions of healthcare or whatever you've got going on over there.
I thought
there.
It was religious beliefs.
Was it? I don't know. Do they teach you much about America over there? What do you learn?
That it's a nice place to make money.
It's a place where people can't really read. And that the people are very friendly, but they don't understand what sarcasm is.
Coming up pretty soon, we will have the wonderful Drew Curtis from Fark.com, as well as comedian Christian Finnegan.
Can you spell that for us? Because it sounds like you're saying a word that you shouldn't
be... F-A-R-K.com.
Okay,
Fark.com.
Just to get it straight.
What is Fark.com?
It's like a news aggregation website, and it's all the news stories in little podunk towns and stuff that you don't... And big towns as well, that you don't normally see in the news media.
So this man knows literally everything.
Yeah. He's on CNN tomorrow morning, and somehow we got him.
Fantastic.
Yeah, excellent.
Stick around. What, do you have something to say?
No. Maybe he won't make it to CNN.
And at some point, you're like Sam Kinison, man. He's on shows. Remember that?
We get him all fired up. He's like, what? CNN? No problem. I'll do it Tuesday.
This is the Lazlow Show. It's time to 923 K-Rock. It is the Lazlow Show, episode 12. We have somehow made it this far, and Reed has already abandoned us, but I guess he's supposed to be coming in at some point from visiting Mommy.
Mommy.
Sitting in.
Mommy's boy.
Sitting in for him would be Gaylord Menzies, comedian, British. You said earlier you were a troubadour. What is that?
Yeah, what is that?
I move around and earn money with my wits and my loot.
you have a loot.
There's not much money in it these days. Not since the 12th century.
I see. And but you used to work in England, and now you're here in America.
Yes.
Well, I'm sure you've been here for, what, 3-4 years?
Something like that.
Yeah. And he's always asking me, Wayne, that I've got to take him to the South, but he's scared to go by himself.
Oh, you'll love it.
I don't want to be towed behind a car on a rope.
Oh, I got to tell you, Dan, even myself, I go down there, you keep your mouth shut.
Absolutely.
Because they know Yankee.
Yeah, they hate
they know
they hate
Yankee.
They may not know many words, but they know that one. And they're still bitter.
They're very bitter.
I know. You know, one of the stories I saw out of the hurricane was evidently a famous museum that had a lot of memorabilia from the Civil War was washed into the ocean. And it was Confederate history buffs that were quite upset. I predicted right after the hurricane that this was going to happen because I know how sort of crazy the religious South can get, but Alabama State Senator Hank Irwin says that the hurricane is caused by sinners.
Well, I think if you look at what's going on, this whole region has always known that with the church that New Orleans and the Gulf Coast are known for sin. And if you go to a church and you read your Bible, you're always told avoid sin.
So, that's the problem with God, isn't it? He's got the worst friends in the world. you look at his friends and they are terrible people, almost without exception. I mean, there are some wonderful ones, but they all seem to have a little few issues. George Bush, big friend of God. Tony Blair, his fluffer, big friend of God. The Pope, big friend of God.
No, I think the Pope is a big friend of Hitler Youth, wasn't he?
Well, the Pope was in Hitler Youth.
The current Pope.
Yeah, which I think's a little bit odd. I mean, everyone's got a few youthful indiscretions. Wayne was telling us about his eight balls earlier.
Yeah.
But
that's
you know,
the only ones. Those are the light ones.
Yeah, but
this guy did a bit of drugs. That guy did a bit of crime. This guy walked with the Nazis. It's a little bit of a scale thing, isn't it?
I mean, you were pretty calm with that walk with the Nazis. You could have took that to another step.
He was goose-stepping with them.
Goose-stepping.
One imagined. Who knows?
This guy
is a wonderful man.
This senator keeps digging the hole deeper.
And that there's judgment for sin. And I just think that in my analysis, I can't speak for everybody, but I believe that if you look at the factors, that you had a city that was known for sin. The signature of New Orleans is the French Quarter, Bourbon Street. It is known for sin. And you have a Bible that says God will judge sin. You can put two and two together and say it may not be the judgment of God, but it sure looks like the footprint.
I love that. I can't speak for everybody, but I can speak for God. You've got the right job there in politics.
Yeah, I know. This was on MSNBC, and this is specifically why I do not watch any of this political nonsense.
I see another one. I can't forget what the guy's name was, but the guy's comment was, he came out, he said, if abortion was legal in New Orleans, that the prison population would be less. And he was trying to insinuate that if these young black women had more abortions, that there would be a less...
Who is this? What did you see this
That was the guy who was...
I thought he was a politician himself.
He was a former politician in the George Bush 1 government.
Yes, and
the first empire, the first
His name was Bill Bennett.
Oh, he's, so you know about it.
He's a talk radio host, and this is the caller that started that comment. This is this week.
That, the abortions that have happened since Roe v. Wade... the lost revenue for the people who have been aborted during the last 30-something years.
I got to stop this. Right? This guy, I've never heard anybody tackle this issue from a financial. You know, he's got like an Excel spreadsheet, and he's like, God damn, I wouldn't have to pay so many taxes if they'd stop having, you know.
True Republican.
Listen, it gets worse.
Could fund Social Security as we know it today.
Obviously, the Social Security issue... could be solved right there today if there were more people.
More people? I thought less people.
No, what he's saying, if we made abortion illegal and all those people were forced to have children, those are more...
People to work and pay tax.
Right.
I gotcha.
Could fund Social Security as we know it today. And, the media does never touches this at all.
It probably be because you're a lunatic. Wacko. Who calls into these? This is why we don't take calls. Like, Wayne and I tried taking calls on this show, and it was just...
You get Chinese people with, like, a lisp.
What would you say if that guy called up your show and said that?
I agree 100%.
I would hang up on him.
No, you wouldn't. Yes, that has got entertaining value.
That never touches this at all.
Assuming they're all productive citizens?
Assuming that they are. Even if only a portion of them were, it would be an enormous amount of revenue.
Does this guy not know about the concept of immigration?
Hasn't he ever heard of illegal aliens? Come on. So that was the caller that set this up. This was in like all the papers and the media and everything. This Bill Bennett, who was a politician and now has some kind of crazy right wing blather talk show. This is the comment that got him in trouble this week.
You know, one of the arguments in this book, Freakonomics, that they make is that the declining crime rate, you know, this they deal with this hypothesis that one of the reasons crime is down is that abortion is up. But I do know that it's true that if you wanted to reduce crime, you could, if that were your sole purpose. You could abort every black baby in this country and your crime rate would go down. That would be an impossible, ridiculous, and morally reprehensible thing to do. But your crime rate would go down.
That would be appalling, but I'm still in favor of it. My career's gone down the pan.
I was looking at the wrap-up of stuff that, you know, you go to these blogs and things, they talk about that what's going on in TV news and, and so forth. I couldn't believe it.
I believe it.
These bad people are out of their minds.
Believe me, there's a lot more people that think along them lines than you think.
Yeah. So
this country is chock-a-block full of racists.
There's white people willing to pay for those abortions.
Okay. Back to Alabama State Senator Hank Irwin, who on MSNBC, as we were playing that previous bit, was saying that the hurricane hit New Orleans because women show their boobs for beads, essentially.
Not global warming.
No.
Global warming is a lie.
Boobies.
Instead, it's because of sin.
Woo!
And so the guy on MSNBC said, well, you know, it's kind of interesting that you say that, it was because of Bourbon Street, because Bourbon Street was one of the only places that didn't flood.
I saw young children, 15-month-old babies, who were suffering. I saw in New Orleans, young children. I mean, you look on TV, you see young babies dying on the sidewalk of heat exhaustion.
And the entire time, I must interject, they've got that split screen. This Alabama senator is nodding his head and smiling.
Certainly, these babies aren't sinful, are they? Should they be made to pay for the sins of tourists from Florida that go over and gamble in New Orleans and Biloxi?
Well, I think you need to understand that wherever sin goes, the sins of a few can affect the innocence of many.
So, dude, if there's sinners around you, like right now...
We're getting polluted by Wayne?
Right.
You're going down. It's getting warm in here.
this whole building could just...
Without a doubt.
Explode.
Oh, just because of me.
Because of
the sinning I've done.
Dude, the stories you've told on this show.
Well, then the biggest earthquake tsunami's heading your way, okay? According to that guy.
And I think that you're seeing also along the Gulf Coast, as well as in the neighbors of our good state of Mississippi, a lot of innocent people that were affected by this hurricane. And that's the tragedy of sin, is that you never sin alone. You always affect other people.
And that's the tragedy of sin. It's the tragedy of democracy. Someone like that got elected.
No kidding, but, you know, he's an Alabama state senator.
And we've had a lot of innocent people have been hurt.
But you know, Senator, though, I mean, the thing about the New Orleans storm is that it was the French Quarter that seemed to be spared of devastation.
Well, I understand that, and I think the Lord sent them a message that we need to turn around or we may have another hurricane come.
You're going to have another hurricane, stupid. You live on the ocean. Big storms come through.
It's quite a warning from God, though, isn't it? I'm going to drown all of your neighbors.
For your sins.
For your sins.
For you banging your neighbor's wife, I'm taking out you and the whole neighbor's family.
And the queen. And
then,
but Bourbon Street untouched.
Right. And I'm letting your Walmarts and your electronic stores all get looted.
Yeah.
And I just think the people have been going in there, the church people have been going into the French Quarter for years, appealing for the people to turn around and get back right with God.
I've been to New Orleans a couple of times. I didn't see any church people.
On Sunday morning.
No, not that. I'm just saying on Bourbon Street and the whole mess down there.
As you were handing out beads to teenage girls, you didn't see them trying to pull you back into the church.
Handing out tracts that say, you know, the big one is coming. You know, what do you want to expect? You live in a swamp.
So I think the message needs to go even stronger. Please turn around so we never have to go through this again.
That's great.
Yeah. I had one friend tell me they should just knock down those levees and call it Venice, too. That's all. Just everyone lives in a boat.
Well, Venice has got its issues as well. I mean, I've never been there.
I've been.
Yeah.
It's sinking into the mud.
Pretty much the same
beautiful
issue.
Place.
Pretty much like the same issue, right?
Well, just less people blaming it on God. More blaming it on gravity.
So it's more of a gravity thing than God.
Well, that's how they see it, but they're probably wrong.
So you've been in Venice. My question is, does the water stink? Is there a big stench? Because where does the sewer go?
I think
it has to be the same water.
I think it is the same water. I was there in winter, so it didn't stink too much. I think in summer, it stinks quite a lot.
All right.
And what did you do? The whole boat and the guy singing?
Didn't do that. That seemed a little bit lame. A little bit like you're in a TV commercial.
Really?
You know,
like an American Express TV commercial or something?
There was a big commercial for England called for an ice cream called the Cornetto that was always set in Venice on a gondola.
And so it.
If you're English and you go there, you can't really go in a gondola. Then you would feel like you're in a TV commercial.
Here's what I want to know. You know, there was another bombing in Bali. Is there, like, did a member of Al-Qaeda have, like, a bad vacation there or something? I mean, I thought it was just, like, a vacation place. Is Cancun next?
There's a lot of sinning over there, I heard.
You know, did, like, some Al-Qaeda guy have a bad time at Senor Frogs in Cancun?
Senor. I didn't like that yard-long glass.
These shots are terrible. I would blow you to pieces.
Don't know. It's got to be a bad job working in the Balinese tourist board now, doesn't it?
Twice now.
Appalling.
This was like 25 people died. I never have understood why that place was sort of not that I understand why any of it's a target, but I mean, there's like surfers and tiki girls. It's not exactly, or maybe
those
it's
are the enemies of everyone, aren't they? Tiki girls.
Yeah. Coming up in a bit, I think Reed is supposed to be
landing soon.
He's maybe. I think he's got his scooter.
No, he couldn't. He can't park a scooter at JFK in long term.
No, he's at LaGuardia.
No, still, long term scooters are not acceptable.
Yeah, really?
No, it's the 55-mile-an-hour speed limit in there, he can only do 30. What's he doing?
He's going through little streamers. listening to this over and over in his iPod.
I'm a homosexual. I like them.
Ha 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 ha
Yeah, Reed, tell that taxi cab driver to get his foot on the pedal. Get me to Manhattan as fast as possible. He missed that first hour.
You met Reed once before.
Years ago.
Well, he's now taken to riding a little scooter, and it's a very feminine looking scooter. It's like something.
Aren't they all?
But you being from England and back home, you might find it appropriate.
In England, but not so much here.
Correct. This is something about it being sissy here.
Like in Scotland, a man can wear a dress, but here you get arrested.
Exactly.
Well, you don't, but you're in an alternative lifestyle.
Right.
Everyone's doing it.
Yes, exactly.
All their everyday dresses.
And I got to say, when I was over there, they're all hardcore, those scooter people.
Yeah,
you got to get out of their way. Reed stops for you. You know what I'm saying? Where in England, I've been there, they kind of just like keep, you know.
But Reed's driving a scooter because he's scared of a bike.
We're not sure why he's driving a scooter.
We don't know. We'll ask him when he gets here.
Yeah.
But he's very defensive about his little scooter, too.
It's not a Vespa. It's a Yamaha.
You bodyboarders are defensive about that compared to surfing.
No, but there's something...
No, we're offensive if you call it boogie boarding.
It's about... Oh, by the way,
what about entrees?
Entrees?
Well, the nasty phrase I heard for it was, rhymes with tray, entree.
Oh, gays on trays?
Yeah. Can we say that?
Sure.
You just did.
I don't know what. I didn't. He did. He'll be the one that gets fined.
He's very nervous because over in England, you can say anything you want, can't you?
Well, within reason. You're not going to get fined if you swear.
Really?
No, it's the free speech actually means free there as opposed to $250,000 or you hit the special stop swearing button.
Right now, I'm going
to. Do you want to try it out?
I don't want to try it out. This is the home of rock and roll, and rock and roll people don't swear.
Oh, yeah.
They sell you things.
I'm going to hit the Aussie button. K Rock, it is the Lazlow Show. Maybe join us, Wayne. What are you doing out in the hall, looking for Red Bulls in somebody's
The Red Bull refrigerator is empty.
Somebody was complaining on the or whining this week that
whining over something he doesn't even pay for himself.
Stealing Red Bulls because there's a little green room there and there's Red Bulls in it and
it's like unlimited when you're here.
So while we were talking about Reed and playing some sound effects, he was actually trapped out in the lobby behind the locked door at K Rock.
It's quite cute.
And
it's like I want that puppy in the window.
So you went out there to go to the bathroom or something.
I was going to get drinks.
Reed's face smashed up against the window at the
camera. He's kind of like, he looked like a burglar. Actually, he was trying to jimmy the door open. He's got out his magnetic strip from his ATM.
And and meanwhile, I guess you heard we had a little sound for your scooter.
I heard.
The other bit was sort of a clip of Boy George has these videos now. You can pay to send them to people's cell phones. And if you want to tell your parents that you're gay, you can have Boy George show up on their cell phone.
Hello, Mom and Dad, sit down. I'm channeling a message from your son. Take a deep breath and relax. I'm a homosexual! I like men! Get over it.
So.
And how much does that cost again?
Like $70.
I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. That's a very special way to break it to your parents.
Reed and I were talking this week that the website for the show got so much traffic that it was melting and racking up hundreds and hundreds of dollars in fees because I was getting people from Uruguay. Is that pronounced correctly?
Uruguay.
Now, how do they find out about the show? Do you have any idea?
Send
you an email?
My superintendent is from Uruguay.
Well, it wasn't him. It was some guy down there. And I don't know exactly what it is, but it says, "Hi, it is me, Santi." S-A-N-T-I.
Santi.
Mm-hmm. Yesterday I was at school. I tried to date a girl, but she said no with a little smile, like saying, hey, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but I really don't like you. So tell me, what would you do? So I'm assuming that this is addressed to Wayne, because he's the romantic guy on the...
Sure, it's not just porn spam.
I guess I'm gonna work with photographs and use it myself, my hand, to the photographs.
So
if you can't have it, next best thing is a photograph.
So take pictures of her.
Correct.
Okay, and then fantasize.
And then fantasize.
Okay, well.
Stalking.
When's the stalking?
No, it's not stalking. It would be repeatedly taking pictures.
What was that word again?
Repeatedly.
So after you've repeatedly taken the photographs,
what
do you do with them?
Go home, make a nice little collage for yourself. And nowadays with Photoshop, you can cut the heads off and put them on naked models. So, come on.
And that's not stalking.
That's still not stalking.
What is the technical term for that then?
I think like if I...
Art.
No, I think like if you have an apartment and you find me in your apartment, I'm stalking you.
Okay.
What if you name one of your pillows
I'll look
after
out for
them?
That.
The pillow thing is fine.
All right.
Are you up to naming pillows yet, Reed?
No, but that might creep a lot of girls out.
You should tell Gaylord.
Gaylord. Mm-hmm.
About the pillow. Do you know about the pillow thing?
I don't know about the pillow
thing. Wayne has several pillows in his bed that he has named after women, and he humps them.
Sure.
Humps them how?
You dry hump them as you're going to sleep, you know? You got that erection, you're not quite... Can I say erection? I guess I can.
And we are okay.
It's a medical term.
There we go.
It was a medical term.
It was a medical term.
But anyway, you know...
You made it for an hour and 25 minutes, and you've already...
Only now you've been fined $250,000.
That fourth Red Bull that's put me over the limit. And there's like 18 more, and I'm determined to drink them.
Okay, so...
But you lost me now. What were we talking about?
Your pillows.
Oh, my pillows, yeah.
Yes.
So you kind of like, you know, you find yourself semi, okay, and, you know, you're not, right, you kind of fantasize and thinking of, you know, different women you know, and you're falling asleep and you're just kind of grinding the pillow.
Romantic moments with Big Wayne.
Now, do you wash the pillows? That's what I want.
Never wash the pillows.
Oh, that's
ever.
Yeah, but nothing, you don't ejaculate onto, can I say
another
that?
Another medical term.
Can I say
that's
that?
A medical term, it's fine.
And we're dumping out again. Okay.
Well, not quite sure if that word could.
No, you can't, I don't care if it's a medical term. You cannot say it, Wayne. My God, we're, you know.
There's 500,000 and I'm in Brazil.
What?
Yep. If I did it twice, I'm going to have to pay two times, right? Two fines.
Oh,
is that correct? Yes. Two fines. So I'm at 500,000.
And you're on the plane to Brazil.
I'm on the plane to Brazil.
I'm going to do the show. Where are you going to get that money?
That's why I'm in Brazil, because I ain't got the money.
Well,
okay?
Let me.
They should make the fine reasonable. $250? I'd blurt it out every hour. You know? I can pay four $250 fines. I can't pay four.
That's an ounce of weed each.
Yeah, but it's worth saying the occasional, you know.
Right. You just got to learn the right words, Wayne.
So like what is the right word?
So the right word is I don't finish up on my pillows.
Okay.
It's not for
reach an end point on your pillows.
Correct.
No.
It's just like a meditating state.
It's a mid-range.
Correct.
Relaxing.
Right. Correct. And occasionally, you know, the old lady looks at me and says, "All right, come on."
Put her away now.
But you know, the point of this whole story was that he names his pillows, and they each have names, which is cool because some of them are named after celebrities, right, Wayne?
Okay. Yeah, I have
which
a Britney
cool.
Spears.
Yeah. But then
I had a Madonna for a while, but Madonna got really dogged.
Madonna gets thrown away and replaced with a new pillow?
Yes.
Or renamed?
No, new pillows.
Something else?
Yeah, they got about, a every yearly turnover.
Okay.
Something like
that.
I have five pillows, fellas.
It's just like Hollywood, where new starlets replace the old worn-out starlets.
Correct, exactly.
Okay. See, who's the latest acquisition?
I would still be Britney. I kind of go with that. That trailer park pregnant thing kind of works for me.
But I thought that some of your pillows...
That's a great atmosphere for a pillow, isn't it?
Yeah.
Some of your pillows are also named after friends' wives.
Correct,
not?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, Gaylord, does that not cross the line for you?
No.
Not at all. It's fine.
Gaylord's
it's fine
English.
To name
you better remember, he's English. Yeah, no, he's down with all these occult things.
Occult.
In England, everybody names pillows after their friends' wives, then dry humps them.
See?
It's a national sport.
See?
Exactly.
Soccer.
That's why we lost the empire.
But how does... But see how it kind of just happens is that I'm a humper. I need to have a pillow near my groin to just fall asleep.
So you can hump.
Right.
But I'm like a whale. I'm a two or three... He's like Fudgy the Whale. Wayne the Whale. Coming up on the show, we've got some more Japanese rap. It was actually sent in by a fan who has been to Japan and sent us some crazy stuff. We've got Drew Curtis of Fark.com, who supposedly is flying into the same airport that Reed just flew into, LaGuardia, and is rushing straight to the studio. Also, Reed booked this comedian whose name is Christian Finnegan.
Yes.
And what is he from?
Probably seen him from. He's on VH1 a lot. He's on Best Week Ever. He's from the Chappelle Show a lot. And people, whenever he's walking around, people stop him. Because you ever see that Real World parody they had on the Chappelle Show where
the
white
guy? No, I
can't
say I did.
Wayne doesn't have cable.
Oh, that's right. I forgot.
Wayne
does
listen,
anyone here
I
watch?
Smoke as much weed as I pay for like my rent.
Right.
Some of your guys' mortgages.
You
okay, there has to be a sacrifice. Cable is one of them. Okay.
Because guess what? When you're that whacked, like that any channel.
That's right.
Any channel is amazing.
The other night, I watched a 2-hour program about Krakatoa. Okay, you know anything about Krakatoa?
No.
Yeah, it turns out it's an island down there by Sumatra, and about 100 years ago, it took the biggest tidal wave that ever was. Mm-hmm. So, that's, you know, I entertain myself with PBS, so I'm good with that.
Learning through weed.
Yeah. Great.
Anyhow, Lazlow, have you ever seen the Chappelle Show?
I've seen almost every episode. All right,
so you know the Real World parody they did where the white guy moved in with a whole house full of black guys? The white guy is Christian Finnegan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And so, and he's going to come on here with a bunch of white guys today, basically. What's happening?
Yeah.
So he was the token white guy on that program, is basically what you're saying.
Well, no, I mean, you know.
Those other white guys?
Yeah, sure. He's played some roles.
No, on the David Chappelle Show, was he the only white guy?
No. Okay. I mean, they have different skits. It depends, you know.
Okay. But just maybe he was the token white guy.
By the way,
you can ask him.
Gaylord, if you'll buy him the Chappelle DVD set or something for Christmas so he can catch up on popular culture.
Don't announce a weed, Gaylord. In your case, you can send over some nice black hash.
Oh, yeah, we still haven't got to Gaylord's stories, because everybody that I've met from England at one point was a junkie. Because these guys that came over from England for like the college exchange program, they were there for a week at the University of Missouri School of Journalism where I was going, and they started dealing acid. One weekend, boom.
I was never a junkie, Lazlow. I never injected.
Okay, that's not a...
That's the qualification for a junkie? You've never injected?
In England? You've got to understand that the country, all it does is... It rains and people are miserable. There's no culture of cheerleaders over there.
Maybe you're miserable because it's raining all the time?
Who knows? Maybe one feeds the other, according to that nice guy from Alabama earlier. The misery is causing the rain in his way of looking at the world.
Big sin over there.
So there's no cheerleaders at the football, soccer matches?
They tried, in the 1980s, under Margaret Thatcher, Britain got very into worshipping America. And so they watched, people started to watch American football, and they tried to introduce the cheerleaders in England, but they were all a bit kind of big-thighed, blotchy women, and it wasn't quite the same as those girls from Dallas. So it never really took off. And no, there's no cheerleading. It's mainly people throwing bottles at each other or shouting racist abuse at one another.
Excellent.
Sounds good to me.
Good stuff.
So we got to do some spots. We'll come back in just a little bit. We're going to go out with... Somebody emailed this to me from the 70s. It's a German band evidently doing an attempt at Black Sabbath. Is this? Reed has a look of ecstasy on his face.
I love this, you know, because I speak a little German. I'm trying to translate the lyrics.
I think she says,
it says something about riding a scooter.
Something about get into the train cars.
Lazlow Show tonight.
Here's the Lazlow Show. Reed said that was Poison.
You're trying to embarrass me because I don't know hair bands. Is that what's going on here?
And
but you know who is that actually? Please,
Chester
please.
Bennington and yeah. Motley Crue.
Who is that? Who is Chester Bennington? Sounds
I don't
like
know.
A butler on.
Dude,
on...
Listen, I don't even want to play like the two songs an hour that we play, and I play one song, and Gaylord is making snotty comments about
which one? The
that you said that was appalling.
It was terrible. If I had to hear that again, I'd kill myself. If I'm honest. You?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Right.
But you know, I sort of do that just as a time killer.
Well, you're on a rock radio show. You've got to play some.
No,
rock music.
I don't. I don't. Have to. I told them
it's
when they
not a rock radio.
When
show.
They called me and said, "Do you want to do a show?" I said, "Don't be surprised if the music disappears. That's just the way it is."
People would rather listen to me, Lazlow, than that music and those million-selling artists
like Chester Bennington, whoever that is, right?
Right.
Who's not gone gold.
Dude, I was on the phone this week trying to get the website thing sorted out, and I'm talking to this guy. His English is terrible. And first off, when you call tech support now, you have to try several times because they're on voice over IP from India or somewhere, and you get a bad connection. They can't hear you. You can't hear them. I'm on the phone with this guy for an hour, and I'm like, and he's driving me crazy. I said, "Where are you?" He goes, "Oh, we're in the Philippines. It's 4 a.m. And didn't we bomb the Philippines at one time or something?
Several times.
Yes, and we should do it again because their tech support sucks. It was rubbish. I would so much rather... There's a computer company that I actually bought my last two computers from called System Max. Their computers are made in America.
For Americans, by Americans.
And you call tech support, you talk to somebody in Ohio, you know, that doesn't want...
Still can't
to,
speak.
I don't know if I want to speak. Still don't know if I want to speak to someone in Ohio.
It's got to be better than talking to somebody over there who's pretending, first off. They have the fake American name. They go to these classes.
Brandy.
Right, Brandy. So, Brandy, you eat steak? Oh, no, I'm a vegetarian.
Tube steak.
I don't know why you're offending people from India, but Wayne, so, you were telling us a story about how your dad used to drink when he babysat you.
Oh, yeah, I was be a great thing on Saturday mornings, you know. My dad would do the big thing, and he's gonna tell my mom, "Oh, I'll take Wayne for the day," you know. And from like 8 to 11, you did some errands, you ran around, you know, you did the dry cleaning, you know, the shoemaker.
Shoemaker? What are you
living a fairy tale?
I don't know. I got a little age overuse, guys. You back in the day, you took the shoes and you got new soles and heels put on them. Are you kidding me?
Right.
There was no new pair of shoes every school year. Spit polish and a new pair of heels. And
was there a cart going down the street with a guy going, "Bring out your dad"?
No, it was a corner store.
Really?
But anyway, so my dad at like sometime around like, you know, 12, 1 o'clock, you know, he was a big drinker, and he
wait, 12, 1 o'clock, what's it?
In
noon.
The afternoon.
Noon.
Sure, in the afternoon. And he, you know, he'd want to go and hang out with his boys for a little while, but, you know, kind of felt trapped with me. So he'd literally park you in a car on a street and give you like dimes to feed the meter for like the next 4 hours, okay? And he could say, "Don't touch no buttons," you know? And 4 hours later, he'd come out of the bar, he'd be S-faced, and, you know, "All right, we're going to, don't tell your mother we were at the bar." Okay, your breath's not going to give it away. Okay, mom's got no idea you've been at the bar for 4 hours. And, you know, so then he'd try to give you hush money, like, "Hey, oh, here's some money for pizza or something," you know? But basically, you sat in the car for 4 hours. And I think about it nowadays, he'd be arrested. You leave your kid in the car for 4 hours. It's like, you know, but he'd come back and every button would be pushed. The windshield wipers would be on. There was every radio station was like tuned to 88. Because this is back when the cars only had AM radios, guys. They didn't have FM. I don't know how old you are, but my car had AM radio.
Use.
Right.
With a mono speaker, it came out of the dashboard.
It was him and Mr. C and Fonzie hanging out in the...
And the best was for me was that my dad couldn't figure out how to put the stations back on because it was like this little thing that you had to pull the knob out forward and then press it back in. You know, so you actually pulled it past the point of where it stuck out normally to set it.
Plus the 11 Jaegers probably didn't...
He wasn't a Jaeger. He was a Chivas Regal guy, dude.
Classy drunk.
Exactly.
Good. It comes with a velvet bag you can put in it. You remember that when people would be like, "Oh, look at this."
Yeah, but hold on. Reed, here's the best part. That's what he liked to drink as far as alcohol, but his beer of choice was probably Rankle or Schaefer.
Gotta like that.
Oh, my God. Reed called me this week. Was it... No, it was. I think he called me on Tuesday, and I go, "How you doing?" He said, "Dude, I'm trying to recover. I went and saw the one man Star Wars show."
Yeah, I'm such a loser.
Unemployment's got you down that bed. You're catching a 1 o'clock matinee.
I'm just catching a little culture, a little culture.
I forgot to tell you, Gaylord Reed's unemployed.
Right
at the time.
Right. There's no shame in that. It's all right. If you need anything done with your yard or any straightening up around the house, give me a ring.
He might need a guy to run around a couple of messages on that scooter of yours. You can get a message uptown and downtown real fast.
I can zip, baby. I can zip. Yeah, have you guys heard about that?
You're slow. You are slow.
There he's going downtown with his package.
I always dreamed of having my own theme music, but you know, in my own head, it
my
didn't sound
chickadee.
Like that.
You know why I'm slow? Because that set on the racist alarm button
is set for first.
For number one position because of you. There's two buttons in here. The racist alarm for Wayne and the, oh my God, we have to dump out a delay. Wayne just said something completely inappropriate about a 10-year-old girl in a thong.
Right. And I've been here 20 minutes and it's happened twice. So
see what you bring to the show?
Thank you.
So the one-man Star Wars
show. Oh, right. Have you guys heard about this? It's called the one-man Star Wars trilogy. Anyone? Do you like Star Wars, Gaylord?
Not massively, but I have heard of it.
Massive. It was Ali G. No, it's this one guy. He's
hey,
from
don't
Canada.
Say that. Don't say that. Saying you're stealing someone else's material.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
You know, you don't want to be stepping on no toes over here.
Evidently, used to dress up and interview members of Parliament. so because you know everybody's ripping him off
as a b-boy.
Yeah,
I'm ripping him off right now with these Red Bulls. I hope he goes broke.
You'll need to drink about 47 million of them.
I'm starting.
Yeah, keep on going. But anyway, he's this Canadian actor, and basically what he does is... What do you got against
Canada,
man? Sci-fi
freaks just can't stop, can they?
But that's the thing, he's not. He's more of a serious actor, you know? He talked to me for like 45 minutes about the...
So you were interviewing him for like a magazine or something?
Yeah, for an article I was writing.
Is that what he told you, he was a serious actor?
That's what he told me, yeah. But I think
I'm done
that
with
meant,
Hamlet, now I'm on with being...
A droid.
C-3PO and R2-D2, both at the same time.
I think it meant he'd done some porn, but you know, he takes all the original three Star Wars trilogies and just does a one-man version of them where he condenses all three movies down into like an hour, and it's just like manic crazy.
See,
you know,
I
he
need
plays
that.
All the characters. Do you want to see that?
I would like to see it because I never seen one of them.
You haven't seen any of them?
And I don't think I have 9 hours to watch three of them, so if the guy can condense them down into like an hour... I'd see all three movies.
While all the other kids, you know, are out at the movie theater seeing Star Wars when they're young, you're sitting in a locked car when your dad is drunk in the bar.
No, that was adolescence. I'm pretty sure when Star Wars came out, I was more about getting baked than I was going to see Star Wars.
Babysitting with the rails.
Exactly.
But how can you be male in America and not grow up and see Star Wars?
Because if you live in Queens and had a coke addiction,
you're in a different kind of space.
You had your own Star Wars. You were out taking cars, lighting them up.
Yeah, that was true. Well, it's bad here, but I read over in England, Gaylord, that like 30% of English people identify their religion as Jedi Knight. Have you heard about this, Lazlow?
I think it was 8%, but
I like to
more than the none percent you'd hope it would be.
Because you have to fill out some form when you
religion, and one of the options was Jedi. What's happened to our country? I was hearing though, Reed, that the 1 hour people that you know they do the 1 hour Star Wars,
they do
the 1 hour Shakespeare, they're now doing the 1 hour Bible.
Oh, is that
well,
right?
They're getting a whole Bible in 1 hour. People that can't be bothered to read no longer have to say I'm spiritual. They can now actually say I'm religious.
I need that one too.
Right.
As long as they get to the part where in the first bit where it's okay to have concubines and sell your daughters into slavery. One of my favorite sections.
Right. That's good stuff. And the part where you can eat locusts but not a pig. You know, it's like how do we condense that down and make it
half of that out?
Mm-hmm.
I think there was a lot of editing done over the years. This is the Lazlow Show. This show and previous episodes archived at lazlow.com. And as Wayne pointed out earlier,
we're going to start to charge a small fee.
No, we're not charging a fee. It's up there for free for now.
For the video messages, you're charging a fee.
Yes,
Wayne will dump your girlfriend for you,
without a doubt.
You're a whore.
Actually,
I'm not going to do it over the phone. I'm going to come and do it in face for you, like you know, like delivering roses and stuff. You know, I show up in a little tuxedo. I'll groom the beard up a little bit. I'll neaten it up, and I'll come here and be like, "Hey, I'm here to tell you that you are over. You are a hoo-ah."
This is the Lazlow Show. Monday's old. Lazlow Show.
Yo, it's Patrick, your intern.
You're not the intern yet, buddy.
Well, yeah. How about we do this interview tonight at Fridays, huh?
What? Oh, you want to do the interview tonight at Fridays?
Yeah, why not?
You do it, buddy. You be there. We'll be there about 10:20, 10:25.
10:20 to Fridays inside Grand Central?
That's it. Hey, we're going to have a...
No, not Grand Central, bro. Penn Station.
Penn Station. What do you look like, buddy?
I got a Phillies hat on and a red goatee.
What are you going to have? A red hat?
Yeah, I got a red Philadelphia hat and a red goatee.
All right,
just because the cops going to have to come over and pad you down.
What's that?
You know, we got to have someone come over and pat you down.
Dude, you might. Wayne's famous. You might want to knife him.
You know,
what's up?
I don't got my bodyguard with me tonight, so I need to make sure that you got clearance.
Well, you got Wayne with you, right? He's tough enough, isn't he?
Yeah, but I have a bodyguard also, because I can't physically hit you if you hit me. Then I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing here.
but make sure, if you really want to bring an intern for the show, then you should bring an ounce of weed.
Ounce of weed. I got a 12-pack of Diet Coke. How's that going to
do? Hold on. The 12 Diet Coke, I got one even better. You got a girlfriend?
No, I'm single at the moment.
All right.
I just broke up with my girlfriend because she was a big cokehead, so, you know.
You're perfect.
My type of chick. You be down there.
All right, I'll be there. 20 after 10.
20 after 10.
All right, peace.
We have to have, like, a full-scale real competition, though. We can't just pick the first guy.
No, Wayne. Of course not. He's just coming in for an interview.
Oh, an interview.
What kind of questions are you guys going to ask him? He's going to bring a resume? What do you got over there, Wayne?
Well, I really think we're just going to go for a visual. I think it's you being the producer. It's up to you decipher if this guy's going to... He has to do what you tell him to do, not what I tell him to do. You're the head here. You produce the show.
What? When did I get in charge?
You're in charge now.
All right. By the way,
there's only one man in charge, our noble leader, Lazlow.
By the way, Gaylord filled in for you very well.
Did he?
It's a tough technical job sitting here speaking. But I pulled it off apart from a bit when I stuttered.
It is very difficult. Sometimes you have to run down and get the guests. Sometimes you have to get a drink. You know, you have to make some phone calls.
Yeah, Drew Curtis of Fark.com is supposed to be here.
Again, every time you say it, it just...
Fark, F-A-R-K.com.
Yeah, spell it. I don't want to see you get in trouble.
Wow. We just did. F-A-R-K. Man, you want us to write it on your hand?
No, but I think every time he says it, it sounds too close to another word that you don't belong saying.
Okay.
Don't you agree?
How many Red Bulls have you had?
3 Red Bulls.
You remember...
Okay. Thanks to Howard.
Dude, I would like you to remember the last time that you had 2 Red Bulls.
Yeah, man.
I had to dump out because you cursed, and you've had 3, and I've dumped out on you twice now.
But it's all good comedy.
Right.
We need a couple female interns, too. I'm not just happy with the guy intern thing.
I got emails this week. That was Patrick who just called us, who says that he has radio experience. He's taking a broadcasting class.
That's great.
That's important.
Most of my work has been in print journalism. I actually interned at an abortion clinic last year.
I like this guy's getting 2 checks already.
Yeah, so, what does the intern do at an abortion clinic exactly?
So far, he's...
what does he do? Take the fetus out to the dump?
Right,
yeah.
It's a backplane hacky sack. Right. You know what, Gaylord? You were right. You said you were going to come on the show, and it was going to be our last. So he's interned at an abortion clinic, and his next step up the ladder of success would be us.
Right. But he just doesn't know what he's going to find when he gets
here. A classic career move.
Right.
Yeah. But if somebody else wants to be, you know, we're now accepting applications.
Right.
You could say.
And I got a second one from Jerry Portella. It says, I'm interested in an internship. Big fan of your show, as well as O&A and Ron and Fez. I used to run a website dedicated to strange and twisted things I would find on the internet. I guess the FBI or something. Right. You know what, dude? Please make a note, Reed. All of these interns, get their legal names and do one of those sexual offender searches.
I've checked their credit.
Weren't you on one of those lists accidentally once?
Oh, that's right. I remember you telling me.
Yeah, I was get arrested for being a sex pest.
I was going through. I was coming back from overseas, and I was at Newark Airport. And the second part of that story is I'd swallowed the evidence before we got on the plane. We had some stuff left
don't
over.
Ever say you swallowed.
Don't ever say you swallowed anything ever again.
Okay, here's the deal. We had been through Amsterdam, and we had extra, and so I ate it. And then I got on the plane.
And extra?
Extra stuff, and I giggled the whole way home.
Extra stuff.
And I was giggling going through customs, and then they said... the woman got this concerned look on her face, and she says, have you ever lived in South Carolina? And I said, no, I've never even been to South Carolina. I've been in North Carolina, you know, surf the Outer Banks. And she calls like a...
Bodyboard.
Calls a guy over.
We still refer to it as surfing, okay?
And he comes... Okay. This guy comes, I'm like, what's going on? And they take me into this room full of Asians... nervous-looking Asians and nervous-looking Hispanics. That have all got that, like, oh no, I'm being shipped back look.
oh no, I've got a kilo of coke up my
And they each have a black eye.
And so then I started to call my buddy and say, dude, something's going down here, man. Maybe my eyes are real red or I don't know what's going on. And they said, get off your cell phone. And then the guy finally called me up and started to interrogate me. And he's really nasty. And he's like, you know, why are you flying into this airport instead of Kennedy? And I was like, because you live by Kennedy. I was like, because the flights were cheaper. Didn't really know that was a problem. And so he's asking me all these questions, like, you ever had any trouble with the law? And I said, no, my dad was a cop. And,
yeah.
You know, every time we throw...
That was Lazlow's line growing up. Someone beat him up. My dad's a cop.
No.
Stop hitting me.
You get pulled over. You get pulled over. Thank you. You get pulled over.
I've got a little replica badge.
Yes, exactly. Plastic. And all that means that you donated money.
And I would have a suitcase of beer behind the seat, and we would be driving around drinking beers. And when we got caught, that's what you'd say. My dad's a cop.
And what would they do? Just take the beers? Or
they pour it out.
Really? Don't they give you one of these like special cards? Because one of my friends, his father's a cop in New York City, and the dude can do no wrong. It does not matter what he does. He has this card that he just shows.
The PBA card.
Or something like that.
No, it's a PBA card.
Is that
he
what
can
it
only
is?
Get over with a misdemeanor. Another cop's. Another.
He can't kill someone.
Right. He can urinate in the street.
Uh-huh.
He can smoke. He can spit like on a subway platform. But you know, he violently assaults everything someone. That little guard is shredded.
Right.
That's one of the things I've never understood but loved about this country is that if you contribute money to the police, you get a card that basically you're supposed to flash when you get into trouble.
And there is actually
isn't that
even
a bribe? Isn't that just called a bribe?
Pretty much.
Well, so that's what I don't understand. It's like, why, you know, they call me too, the Benevolent Association. I'm like, you know, is this is your job? I don't have my accountant ringing me up for some charity. I mean, it's like, why, you know, why are you?
It's also known that the cop that would pull you over and you would show this PBA card to, he will confiscate the card. It's like,
so you got to buy another one.
Oh, but hold it. Now it's his. He doesn't turn it in back to the PBA board or whatever.
Was he showing it to other cops? No. Like, I got a whole collection.
He gives it to his friends, sure, so that they all can say, hey, look, I got one of these over here.
I will have to say there was a cop radio show that was done at the old radio station I used to work at, and this guy gave me not just he gave me this full thing with like a metal badge, like this little. I mean, it was like really, he goes, you show this, we're like brotherhood.
You can pretend to be your own
I got
to
tell you, you go into a pawn shop, you can buy him for $10. Just so you know, okay?
But
no doubt about
it. You can go into a porn shop and buy a PBA card.
No, one of those little brass badges you're talking about.
Why at a porn shop?
Because someone stole it from a cop and sold it.
Oh.
Hold on a second.
A pawn shop.
How do you steal from a cop? Like they're not.
Hold on a second. Wayne,
yes.
Your language, your command of the English language, you're saying a porn shop or
porn. A P-A-W-N.
I'm like, what the hell did
porn
they
shop. I was like, what?
There's two rednecks. You probably sold more. You probably half your living room since been in the porn shop. Okay.
My living room's been in a porn, no, but not a pawn shop.
Yeah, okay.
Nice.
And you're calling us rednecks, and you put a Z on the end of every word.
Use.
I get email guys. From fans of this show that says, use guys rock.
Nice. But I always wondered, Lazlow, like, how do you, when the cop pulls you over, if you've done something wrong, how do you delicately pull out that card or just mention that your father just happens to be a cop?
You have it in your wallet.
It's supposed to be the front. As soon as you open up your wallet, it's supposed to kind of like fall out like a $50 bill. Oh, excuse me. Look at that.
Is that how
my PBA card fell out?
So, but how would you mention that your father's a cop? Like, how do you do that gracefully? Do you just blurt it right out?
Sure.
Laz did it while he was yelling with his hands above his head. Ah, my father's a cop!
Dude, when I got pulled over, there was... I mean, there was a few, like, I was legitimately whacked. And, I would just say, because they say, where are you going? You know, they always say, where are you headed?
Nowhere.
I'm going to Lieutenant so-and-so's
Lieutenant
house.
Lieutenant Jones's house. Yeah. This one time I got pulled over, we're coming back from a club, and there's also the lights go on in the background. And, you know, we've been partying at this club, smoking, drinking, whatever. And The cop lights come on, and this big, fat, black cop with this, I never forget this, had, you know when a regular cigarette's not enough and you've got the 120? You know what I mean? You know, it's like the
baseball bat.
Right. He's got a menthol 120 hanging from his lip, and he comes sauntering up, and he's like, "How we doing tonight?" And I'm like, "I'm doing great, dude." And he's like, "Do you notice you just went through 3 red lights?" And I was like, "Oh, I was kind of talking to my friend." He goes, "I noticed your head was sideways the whole time."
Man.
And he's like, "Where are you going?" I said, and he had that look on his face like, "I can't wait to throw you, you know, a-holes in jail." And I said, "I'm going to Lieutenant Lucian Jones's house down." He's like, "That's your daddy? You tell him I said hello, officer." Pete Tendleton said hello. And let me go.
Man, you're like Uday Hussein up in this piece. You're just rolling around, like, taking girls where you please, riding with an AK-47.
Right, then I went right there and chopped some arms off some Sunnis.
So you never got in trouble. He wouldn't even tell your dad that you were just driving around with a case of beer?
I did have one who, you know, went and narked to my father and said he caught me doing twice the speed limit.
Was your father a ranking officer?
You mean officer and a gentleman? What do you mean?
No, like he was a captain, a sergeant, a lieutenant.
He was a lieutenant.
Okay.
Which I've said about 3 times.
Those little badges that I was... I'm sorry, that part missed me. But
yeah, you're still back in the porn shop.
But those little gold badges that you guys were talking about, that was actually, if you were hired as a New York City police officer, you were given those to give to your family members. And they usually had your badge number on.
Yeah, that's what I got. I had one of the badge numbers.
Oh, yeah. That's very interesting. It was definitely a get-out-of-jail-free card, without a doubt.
Right. And I've lost it. Newark. I'm in Newark.
Okay, and we started like 25 minutes ago.
I'm getting questioned by Immigrations and Customs, and they are on and on, like, "What were you doing in Europe?" And I said, "I was going to the largest technology convention on the planet is in Germany each year, and I go
blah,
there
blah, blah.
For my thing." That's what I'm saying, it's part of the story. And I think I dropped in there that I wrote for Playboy, because, you know, nobody that writes for Playboy could be a sex offender. And so they grudgingly let me go. And then I found out that there was, looking through the news, there was a dude with my same name that was on the run as a sex offender.
Imagine that.
Really? So, yeah.
So how did they know it wasn't you?
Huh?
How did they eventually find out it wasn't you?
Wasn't you.
They have a room there. They have a room there with little girls, and you look in, and if you get excited, off you go. I don't know. Let me go. Coming up on the show, supposedly, we have not heard from Drew Curtis of FARC, but we have comedian Christian Finnegan coming in. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true.
Are you coloring again over there?
No, I'm kind of just, you know, over here doing things.
Last time I was looking, he literally had markers, and he was coloring on the front of the New York.
And I was staying in the lines.
In the front of the New York Post.
It wasn't like I was coming out of the lines.
Oh, Gaylord, man. Is this all that you thought it would be? The train wreck that is the
all
last
and a
show?
Whole lot less.
Whew, this is the Lazlow Show. Now, 93K Rock, it is the Lazlow Show. It's so difficult to get Wayne to stop talking so that we can end the song.
Because there should be no songs.
Okay, then you must talk for the rest of the show. Go.
No, all right, so you want me to tell them about my full body search that time when I landed in England? Speaking back, you know, to Laszlo's big, I got pulled into the room. You didn't even know what scared is, okay? What? I flew for 7 hours. I had about 15 absolute of those little bottles. I walked off this
from where?
Plane from, where was I? I left from Kennedy.
Going where?
And I went to Heathrow in London.
I'm back again in 15 hours.
Oh, no, 7 hours getting there, but I had 15 of those little bottles.
Okay. And you, and so
oh,
you
I was up, inebriated.
And you still had, at that point, you had the beard, dreadlock beard.
Actually,
down your
waist. At that time, I didn't have the dreadlock beard. When I was there, that was my influence. I met someone that had that I was influenced by, and I had to come back home and duplicate it.
You know, it's funny when you're walking down the street with Wayne, or we were in a bar last weekend, and some guy is just, people just sit there and stare at his beard. And then we'll strike up a conversation, and you can just see it on their face. They're just waiting for the moment. This guy last week, he's like, "Dude, what is the story with that thing?"
How many years? But anyway, I landed at Heathrow. I am literally like a Jimmy Inappropriate. I'm just a sopping wet sponge. The seat I sat in, my wife said, was dripping wet. I'm sitting next to another drunk 40-something-year-old woman that's flying from California for 4 hours, 5 hours longer than me. She's inebriated.
Crying?
No, she was just, she was a happy-go-lucky drunk, but there was very little, there was a lot of conversation between me and her and no one else on the plane.
So they were crying.
It wasn't like a library.
I never understood the people who got drunk on a plane, because really mixed in, you know, well, vodka and motion sickness.
It was a whole thing about that you're not going to have weed for like, you know, 36 hours straight. You know, you're going to dry out. So you need to keep yourself medicated till you get there. So anyway, I did do a credible amount of smoking before I got on the plane. A couple blunts, probably at least two or three blunts. But, you know, when you're flying, you're not thinking of anything. But at one point, I read my passport, which was the very first passport I ever was issued or had. And it clearly says on the back of it that when you leave the United States, the laws are not like how you think here. Like, you know, you say to a cop, yeah, I'm smoking. All right, I'll throw it away. Give me a ticket. I go to a judge, you know?
Where was that?
Where
on the planet?
In New York, you'd
where
be surprised how many cops
does it say that?
What? No, that you don't have the same rights?
No, I mean, if you smoke weed, you can.
Oh no, it doesn't say that. You just take that for granted in America. Okay. But anyway, so now I'm flying and it's sticking in my head the whole thing. You know, when I get there and I land and we get up to customs and, you know, we brought a couple things for the people we're staying with, and the guy asks what it is and we got a bottle of Absolut, and then all of a sudden, you know, he's being real pleasant. I don't think anything going on, you know. And he says to me, you know,
ooh, hang on. We got a Reed's getting a phone call. Is Christian Finnegan here?
Yes, he is. I go get him.
Oh, that rules, because we just got a call from Drew Curtis of FARC.com. Is sitting at LaGuardia. I hate flying into LaGuardia because your plane lands and they're like, oh, you're going to have to be here for another 2 hours while I'll find you a gate. Because there's like 8 gates there and a billion airlines.
It's crazy. Yeah, and the airline or the airport I flew out of today in Virginia, you know how many gates there were in the whole thing?
One.
Four.
Would you fly Piedmont?
And you know how many people were there? Six. It's like, why do you even have an airport? You know, it's like... Anyway, all right, don't make fun of me while I'm gone.
All right.
Just make fun of my scooter.
All right.
But anyway, I'm there, and I land in the airport.
Oh, hold on. Reed's leaving the room. There he goes. There he goes.
Jiffy music. So anyway, I land, you know, and we go through the custom things. Don't think any of the guy's pleasant as can be. And then he says to me, I need to see you on the other side of this, you know, partition wall, which, you know, the ceiling height is like 12 feet. But they only got... he was going for the glory hole. But the wall's only like 8 feet high, and I go on the other side, and sure enough, I get in the room, and there's two other guys, and they first, you know, hit me with, you know, you got to take your shirt off. I take the shirt off.
Did you kind of do it in a sexy move? Like,
No, you're panicking right now. You're not in 112th precinct. You are now in Heathrow Airport with custom offices. Very serious.
So you weren't like, buncha, wow, you're going to see them on that show, buddy.
No. So I'll get to the good point.
Dude, you're liquored up. I mean.
But this is a sobering experience very fast, okay? And, you know, so the guy gets to me, you take your shoes and socks off. So then he says to me, I need you to unbuckle your pants, put your hands on the wall like as if he's going to frisk you, and he pats me down. He goes, I need to ask you one last thing. I need you to drop your drawers, spread your legs, and put your hands back on the wall.
That's quite a last thing, isn't it?
Yeah, but this is now 15 minutes, and what I don't realize is my wife is just on the other side of the wall, and she hears this whole thing, and she hears me giggling. And I'm like, what more are you supposed to do when a guy's, you know, you're stark naked in a room with three other English guys, all right? And I'm hanging out there, I'm kind of being all cool, and, you know, so the guy says to me, your drawers to your ankles, hands back on the walls, feet spread. And, you know, your pants are all bundled up by your ankle, so it's kind of like a little awkward and everything. And I go to put my two hands on the wall, and all I hear is the rubber gloves snap on the guy's wrist.
Oh,
your favorite sound.
Oh, your favorite sound, exactly. And with that, you know, the guy did the whole, you know, little peeky up there and seen that I was clean and... kind of like, you know,
or not, but
closed up the issue and said, I don't understand why the dog thought you was mewling.
Oh, so a dog set off.
Oh, a dog sniffed me and I didn't pay any attention to it.
No, this isn't customs. They do that to everyone coming into England.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's why I've never been there.
It's a glory hole park. But hold on, the ticket of the story is about, you know, 2 hours later. First of all, I was so paranoid that the guy that was meeting at the airport to pick me up, I said to him, you gotta have something for the minute I get off the plane. I'm gonna be in hysterics. I need to calm down. So he comes walking up to me.
By something you mean?
Some weed. Okay. So, and, you know, as he comes walking up to me, I grab him quick and I go in his ears and I whisper. I was like, don't pass me nothing. Don't show me nothing. They're watching us. They know I'm here for something. I just want to go home. So I go back to my friend's house and we're kind of hanging out. And now I'm into a bottle of some type of cheap vodka, you know, because you don't get really good vodka over there in London.
No, terrible.
Exactly. Plastic bottles and brand name you never heard of from who knows where.
Is that a true story?
Well, you don't get good vodka in England. No, it's nonsense. Of course you do.
He's just agreeing with me because it sounds
trying to get through the story. Just like so we all go home to bed.
But anyway, it turns out I get to my friend's house. I get a couple shots. We get a little smoked up. I relax. And I simulate for my girlfriend and our friend, who's a man. And I do the whole dropping of my pants. And sure enough, I do it for them. And I pull my pants down. And I look back and the two of them are hysterical. You know, so I'm thinking I got some type of stainage back there. It's, you know, schmear or something, you know. It turns out I got a lint ball in the crack of my butt the size of a golf ball. And all I can think about is that poor guy who is the, you know, the officer who strip searched me. He's got to go home and tell his family his day's events. And today, I strip searched this white guy that had a lint ball in the crack of his butt the size of a golf ball.
Wow, that's legit.
Now, that's scary.
Yes.
That's job satisfaction.
On the way back, Laz, I actually also got stopped again, same trip, coming back, because I was infatuated with the Page 3 girls.
Yeah.
Bought this big Sunday.
What's the Page 3 girls?
The Page 3 girls is in the...
The Mirror. Isn't it the Mirror?
It's the Sun, I think.
The Sun, yes.
The Mirror, I think, to a Page 7 girl.
Yes.
It's a girl who, if she was here, would probably be a cheerleader, but there's no cheerleaders in England.
Or an up-and-coming actress, singer.
Yeah, or anything, who instead just poses in the daily newspaper, one of the tabloids, equivalent of the Post, topless.
Which, in our country, is totally taboo. Yeah. Can't see a topless woman.
Work in charity later in her life.
But when you're an American and you go to, you're fascinated with Page 3. You love it. You wake up every morning to run down to get your color glossy of the Page 3 girl. And Samantha Fox is, just to let you know, one of Elizabeth Hurley, Page 3 girl. So you're kind of excited about this. Sunday,
was Elizabeth Hurley a Page 3 girl?
Elizabeth Hurley, who did I say?
You said Samantha Fox. She was.
I think Elizabeth Hurley also was.
I don't know.
All right, well, it sounds good.
That sounds good. It's a good story, anyway.
But anyway, the Sunday issue comes out last, and the Sunday issue is just like Screw Magazine. Okay, they got football scores and porno. Dial-up numbers, this, massage parlors, lingerie, the whole nine yards. So, to entertain my friends, I bring back home the whole week's worth, getting Kennedy, and I'm not allowed to bring back pornography.
What?
Yes.
I've never heard of that.
You're not allowed to bring back pornography.
Into the United States?
Into the United States.
So an English newspaper counts as pornography?
Well, they didn't really consider it pornography. What they did was they kind of went through it page for page, and each page they let me know if there was any bestiality or child pornography, I would be arrested.
Wow.
And because I had a week's worth of papers, it was another 45 minutes of licking the thumb, turning a page. You know, page that got turned, I prayed that there wasn't some 12-year-old little girl or boy, just anything.
I know that Americans don't like to travel, but do the customs guys in here really think they put bestiality in the newspapers in England?
I don't know what they thought.
You're a weird lot over there. I mean,
I just think that they thought that I was trying to bring back something. And again, I was inebriated. It's the only way to fly.
Oh, you think?
That's why they give it to you.
They
want to keep you calm.
I love it. Well, Christian Finnegan should be coming up here pretty soon. He's from the Chappelle Show. Drew Curtis may make it. We don't know. But we'll be back after a little Metallica. I love the gradual fade-out read. It's just you've got a huge, triumphant song, and then it just goes to hell with the fade-out.
Do you even know how many more minutes was left of that?
There was actually 18 minutes left on the Metallica
tune.
Yeah. This is The Lazlow Show. The website is lazlow.com. Now that we've been extorted by Earthlink because we had 80 billion people come download past episodes of the show, you can also see pictures of Wayne with no shirt. At that website. We have in studio Christian Finnegan, a comedian Christian Finnegan, who just came back from some kind of crazy cheerleader tryout, comedian tryout for...
It's basically like what you see in ESPN2, where you have the cheerleading teams. No, it wasn't like that.
Did you throw a girl up in the air and she broke her neck?
Yeah, strangely, though, it had nothing to do with the competition. It was just sort of a Saturday night activity.
So now, is this so comedians can get gigs at colleges? Or
it is just about as close to pure whoredom as you get in the world of comedy. You know, you it's basically they have them in various parts of the country, and you show up and you perform for like all the student activities kids from various colleges. These are like the kids who ran the projector in high school, and now they're determining whether you're going to make money in the coming months or not.
I was shocked that that's the gig that comedians want. Everyone
it pays
I talk
the
about,
most, doesn't it?
I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you don't. It's like you don't want to admit that you want it, but it makes the difference between.
That's the way I am with chicks.
Yeah, it's well, yeah, and there's certain. You know, it's a lot of like, you know, kind of, for lack of a better word, sort of homely. Graduate student women, and then like young, like 18-year-old dudes who just want to drink 40s and like pee on homeless guys. Like that's basically, that's actually, I didn't even make that up. That's what this kid said. He's like, dude, we got to drink.
And
40s.
We are dumping out because you used a bad word.
Did I?
Yes, we've now dumped out of
pee. Did I say pee?
No. And now we're dumping out again.
You got deep pockets. Do you know how much that's going to cost you?
I really apologize.
That's $500,000 worth
funny
of funds.
It's funny because I
we're resetting.
We're resetting. Let's start over. And that was Metallica, everybody, in studio. Comedian Christian, we don't know what the rules are. They haven't really defined it so far. If it makes George Bush uncomfortable, then it's bad.
Okay, good to know. Then I won't use any three-syllable words.
Right.
That's why you're talking so much about cocaine.
Right. See, drugs are fine. Sex
drugs
is fine.
Are bad.
Just no bodily functions. But you were telling me that it's NACA, right? The NACA convention?
Yes, NACA.
That there's a lot of like second runs, right?
Basically, well, it's all, that's basically, you wonder what happens like people in reality shows when the show ends and they all end up at these conferences. They all have these two-hour inspirational speeches that they'll give to students where they talk about, you know, the people who you've seen wasted on the real world will then do these college tours where they will warn you about the dangers of alcohol, which is I think there were two people from the real world, one person from Road Rules, Omarosa was there, jealous much. And of course the star, the superstar of all these conferences is Mr. Belding from Saved by the Bell. He's like big man on campus.
And what kind of Zen wisdom does he have to dispense exactly?
I imagine probably, you know, what to do when Zach and Slater are not getting along. I imagine that's probably 40 minutes of the conversation.
Did he get hired? Did you actually see? Was he getting bookings there?
Apparently. I mean, I don't know because I was stuck at my booth.
Oh, right.
But, you know, they have it like the Javits Center, like one of those places. And it's, you know, it's comedians, musicians, jugglers, magicians.
Are jugglers getting a lot of work these days?
You know, you'd be surprised. They seem to be very popular among the 18-year-olds of Tuscaloosa.
We went to this benefit this weekend, and Wayne was a little smoked up and loaded, and the guy came over to do magic tricks, and it was like watching a 6-year-old.
I was amazed you gave him that. I'm not even going to say it in case he's listening. He gave away a personal object that the guy made disappear, and when it came back, I was like, "You sure that's the right one?"
Yeah. And that made no sense to anyone who wasn't.
Right.
Well, it didn't.
I feel like you just activated some terrorist cell. Like that was such strange code. That was like the fat man walks alone or something. You know, some terrorist cell in Buffalo was just like, oh, it's time to do our thing.
Exactly.
Oh, that's it.
I was just trying to say Wayne was very wide-eyed. Has seen magic.
You know, you're right, though. I mean, because, you know, you think, oh, magic, that's so silly or whatever. But then when somebody's doing it in front of you, you turn into that sort of drooling dude, like, oh, my God.
Some of it is actually good. I'm always embarrassed when I like it. But some of the stuff I've seen, like, what's the guy's name? Chris Angel? I know he's like God.
Mind freak.
Yeah, the mind freak.
That's the dude's show. I'm not just saying a weird word. You're looking at me. This dude's going to murder me. I can tell.
Wayne?
I'm going to end up on a milk
carton.
He's
kind of a scary dude, isn't he?
Does his beard scare you? See, but check this out. He looks really scary, but
it's all good.
Do you take a guess where Wayne likes to party after the show? Go ahead. We have all of New York City available to us.
Okay,
guess where homeboy likes to party? He has a dreadlock beard down Lois' waist.
Chuck E. Cheese.
No.
Close.
But you're close.
Oh, really?
It is a chain.
It is a chain.
Yeah.
TGI Fridays.
You
there
got it.
Oh.
Woo!
Yeah.
Come on,
party
down. You
animal.
Get a free drink.
You get the Jack Daniel's chicken special. The only.
Love it.
Do you put on your flair and then you head on down?
The reason that he likes to go is because there is a bartender there who has a big ass, and he think she's hot.
She's pretty smoking.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like the Spanish girls when they're hot. But Reed's giving me, some stuff for it, but he don't even come at all. You know, it's like, I can't have my scooter and have a
beer.
It's
really hard to get a New Yorker to go to TGI Fridays.
I can't. You know,
it's at the train station. It doesn't count. There's like this
It does count.
You go to the one at the train station?
Yeah.
That's even better.
Right.
So what, Bennigan's is sold out?
Auntie Annie's.
It's the only bar open in the place.
It's the only one with a hot Spanish chick that's willing to give us a buyback. It's basically what it comes back
to. Christian, each week I try to suggest real New York bars that they like to go to, but so far it just hasn't worked out.
We did. We went to one that one night. We went to Playwrights.
They
went to Dallas BBQ.
It's a man's bar. Playwrights I found to be a man's bar, if you know what I'm saying. Just the name of it. Just the name of it.
What, the fact that somebody would write a play makes it one of those kind of bars?
Right. Exactly.
I was a playwriting major in college, I'll have you know.
Were you? So you're
make of that what you will.
See?
Well, in Wayne's world, you know, he's from Queens, basically. So
in Queens. It's hard. And where are you from?
I'm from Boston, but I live in Queens.
What part?
Astoria.
And you got a degree in writing plays?
Yes, I did.
I'm a homosexual!
You know, I should have known that was such a setup.
And he's like, doing signings at Playwright at 10.
Their line for you being gay is very narrow, as you can see. I ride a scooter, therefore queer.
Oh my God, shoes!
Right. What's up?
Yeah, if you can write...
It's a cruel studio.
So I hear that you've got this trick where you can. It's like if somebody has a song or a recent album that they purchased, then you can say what kind of person they are.
Well, it's more a curse, really. I definitely have all just from it. Actually, started when I was in college and you go out with women and you kind of go to their dorm rooms or apartments and you see what CDs they have and you sort of learn to sort of judge people according to what's in their CD collection. Like, you know, if you would see like a Billy Joel CD, you would know that, you know, a lot of cuddling, not a whole lot of action. Like, you'd basically know.
Or she might drive into a tree drunk.
That possibly as well. You know, and if you saw like a lot of Sarah McLachlan albums, you know, probably something like she probably has a journal but never writes in it, like that kind of thing, you know. And
I only wrote in my journal when I got dumped or was drunk anyway. You know,
but that's actually why I started dating my girlfriend, though, is because I found out that she was a huge AC/DC fan, and like that's very rare.
What does it tell you,
a chick?
It tells you, you know, I like to, you know. Mm-hmm.
No, so
she likes it,
like,
back
she
in
likes
black.
A lot.
Well, I'm all panicked now that I said the awful three letter word, the word that dare not speak its name.
I got to show you this Tom Chiasano memo that I got. I mean, it's like 800 pages of Jesus loves you, don't say anything bad.
Who's Tom Chiasano?
He's the guy that runs the head of the station.
Wonderful man.
You don't even work here, and you're afraid of him.
Right. I'm afraid of him. He's just a great guy.
All right, yeah, but, great.
But like, yeah, if you tell me like a band that you like, I will tell. I can try to tell
okay,
you.
Okay, I'm into Kelly Clarkson.
You're into Kelly.
Hold on a second. Who are you into?
Kelly Clarkson.
You can't
Kelly
be that Clarkson. Into her if you don't know how to pronounce her name.
Listen, what am I into?
If you're into Kelly Clarkson, what you're saying is. Hi, nice to meet you. My name is Wayne. By order of the law, I've been told to introduce myself to all my neighbors. I'm sorry, that was a long, weird one. And
wow.
Crickets. Do you have any cricket sound effects?
No.
Is there a tumbleweed you could have roll by? That was.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sorry, that was awful.
That's my theme music, actually, because I ride a scooter, and therefore I date men.
We need to get you a basket with a little dog in the front.
Get some streamers, get a banana seat.
Oh, Lord.
Well, what about some of the music that we play here? Do you get? Because I've seen your shows, and you usually warm the crowd up with that. Like, you ask them to yell out certain bands. Is that right?
Well,
I've seen that before.
I mean, sometimes, yeah.
But do they ever stump you, actually, or have you all heard... of all the bands that they can yell out before.
What it is like if people keep yelling the same kind of band, you sort of run out of jokes, you know. Like,
so like Disturbed and like Ozzy, you might use the same.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if your favorite band is Disturbed, what you're saying is, if I don't have your pizza to within 30 minutes, it's free. That's basically, you know. But, you know, if people say Disturbed, then Stained, then Limp Bizkit, like I've run out of my dumb new metal jokes.
Right,
basically.
Right. Well, how about this? We've been playing Asian rap on the show. People send in
Big fan.
Songs from Asian rap, basically, and you go to some of these websites, it's hysterical. It's like these Asian dudes that are trying to look like California or New York sort of hardcore hip-hop.
But probably like from 10 years ago. They're probably just in that sort of Dr. Dre, Snoop
like
Dogg
California Dreamin'.
Yeah, yeah, they're always about 10 years behind.
So we got this one. This is a band called Nitro Microphone Underground. I guess they just
found it.
Combined
nice.
Some words. I think I heard starch in there. Okay, so they're rapping in some sort of Asian thing there, and the members of the Nitro Microphone Underground are they need to work on their rap names over there. One of them has named himself Gore-Tex, which
that's like a,
let me tell you,
a breathable fabric.
Of all the fabrics, that is definitely the most hardcore.
Right,
hardcore
it's
going
to be polyester, but it's no good. Another guy named himself...
Good impersonation, Lazlow.
Thank you. That's my whatever.
It's too bad you don't have a gong you could hit right after you made that great impression.
Another guy named himself in this rap group. His name is Deli.
Deli.
Nice. Deli.
Just D-E-L-I?
D-E-L-I.
But do you know what's huge over in Japan is what I read is that some people don't speak English so well, so what they do is a big fad is they just take any English word they can find and they put it on a t-shirt and they don't know what it is.
Oh, English.
Yes. English. English. I love that website.
It's crazy.
There's another guy in the group, his name XBS, which stands for Extra Bass Speaker. another one is Big Zam. And one guy just named himself S-Word. He didn't want to go with the full word. He just decided.
That's like, right. like a kindergartner.
That's the radio edit.
He wanted to come strong.
No, he just named. Right, he's already named himself a radio edit kind of word. Yeah. I mean, that's how hardcore. It's like Vanilla Ice. I mean, come on, buddy.
He'll go far though.
Another guy. He named himself More Sex.
More
Sex. These are
so. Is that like he's saying I want it or I have it?
Yeah,
like,
I don't know.
Is it a cry for help?
The
or
videos
is it a brag?
Are hysterical. It's like these 4-foot munchkins with b-boy hats, sort of throwing their hands in the air like they just don't care.
I
found a and I've actually got another track from our good friends. This one from they sound like they're trying to rip off the Beastie Boys here. Very kind of Beastie Boys-ish, it feels like.
Should I be embarrassed that I actually like that? They're actually better than the ones with...
Wait, hold on. They're about to take it to the bridge.
I dig this.
Cool. I found myself sort of liking it.
Yeah, because Christian, we usually play like a Japanese rap, and last week we had some, and usually it's just absolutely terrible. But Lazlow, somebody had sent in the lyrics, right? And the lyrics were hilarious because what they're doing is like they're cutting down their boy's cell phone.
Yeah. Because that's the big thing.
Well, like my plan includes more anytime.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, they're very into the technology. They beam TV shows into their brains or whatever because they're about 10. They're like light years ahead of us.
I've read that.
Because I guess they every time I go to one of these big tech expos, they show some amazing piece of technology, and I'm like, oh, dude. When does that come to America? And they go, 5 years.
Right.
We're going to sell a billion of them in Asia first.
Like those vending machines that dispense panties that we were talking about last week.
When are those coming to Grand Central Station?
I've heard of those for years, though.
We had pictures of them last week.
Yeah.
It's that creeps me out.
Real quick, some other big Asian rap groups, some names of the groups. One is called Wind Forest Volcano.
Love them.
One is 4WD.
4WD.
Sounds like motor oil.
Four-wheel drive. Oh. One is called Buddha Brand.
Okay.
Here's another Asian rap, Japanese rap group, The Blue Herb.
What is the Blue Herb?
I've never smoked anything blue.
Me, the purple.
Another Japanese rap group is Twiggy. Violent Desire Group.
That's a more support group than a rap group.
Here's one of my favorite Asian rap group names, Microphone Pager. Just imagine this Asian guy screaming into his pager. Here's one I like, Bugle Our Rear.
Bugle Our Rear.
Bugle Our Rear, which I guess they were trying to come up with some kind of hardcore term about kiss my butt or something. But and then finally, another person on the charts there doing rap music in Japan, Rhino Latina 2.
That's so, you know, I can't follow what they do because I didn't see Rhino Latina 1. I have a hard time keeping up with the lyrics.
This is the Lazlow Show. Sitting in studio with Christian Finnegan. Did I pronounce that correctly?
You betcha.
Dude, we had this guy last week. His name had like 80 syllables in it. It's like from Kazakhstan or something.
Paravonian? It's four syllables.
Okay.
No, that's five.
he actually sent me another track. If we have time, we will play that if Wayne doesn't put the kibosh on it.
Kiboshed. He's now on the rejection show.
This is the Lazlow Show.
Flight 52.
Mad trail out going on. This is the Lazlow Show, episode 12, the international episode, because we finally had a person from England on the show who was sitting in for Reed, and now he's just sort of hanging out. It's Gaylord Menzies, comedian, troubadour, are you currently employed?
No, I'm currently unemployed.
Okay.
I was fluffing for a while, but now I'm back on the dole.
Fluffing, perfectly acceptable.
Right.
Well, they could
fluffing
be
pillows.
Fluffing pillows.
Not for Wayne before he goes to sleep. Wayne likes to name his pillows after people that he's
associating with.
Associated with, or people's wives.
Yeah. And whoas. So you can say whoas.
Okay, as long as you pronounce it in that particular fashion.
However you like.
Right.
And just for bedtime now, I was at this tech expo of things that are coming out for Christmas and things like that. Or, I'm sorry, the holidays. I can't say Christmas. And they're now mounting televisions inside plush animals.
I've never seen a TV mounted in a monkey.
We actually have a bunch of different TVs in animal, plush animal shapes. They come elephant, lion, zebra, giraffe, monkey, dog. Lots of different ones. Our whole idea is to do something, you know, really radically different.
Right, by making the TV huggable. Yeah. I mean, we that's what we were hoping, is if they could mount TVs and dogs and giraffes and plush animals, that the children could just hug them at night and say, I love you, television!
I mean, that really is, like, the definition of pathetic. I mean, it's like, a lot of people, TV is their best friend in a metaphorical sense, but to actually be hugging on the TV
right.
while, you know, Lingo is playing on a game show network.
And while they've also, for sports junkies, they're actually making TVs that are in the shape of a football or a baseball. There's real leather.
Our Yankees version, and they're all logoed on the back. This one's made of the real Spalding leather, has the same number of stitching as a regulation baseball. And
so it's a New York Yankees television.
Correct. Fully licensed from the NBA and...
Whoa, no, wait. Fully licensed from the NBA.
I don't think that that's...
Fully licensed. Deal not quite signed.
So that guy has no idea what he's selling.
There's a big difference between the people who design these things and the people who actually buy them, I think is what it is.
I like his claim to... it's got the same number of stitching. It's just like the real ball, but it's got a TV in it.
Right.
Yeah. I'm guessing that's more for the single guy. I'm guessing that right. doesn't go over too well in the married
baseball
household.
Has a glory hole in the back. So Reed just flew in LaGuardia. He said a woman was sobbing uncontrollably next to him.
Yeah, you know, because when you sit down on the plane, you know, the worst thing that you could probably get, number one, is the crying baby. But this was number two. I sat down, and there was this woman, as soon as we took off, who just turned towards the window and just started to sob. So you're like, you don't know.
Did she have a black eye?
Blood was running out of her ear. No, I don't know. See, that's the thing, is sometimes you feel like you want to be a good human being and say, you know, is there anything I can do for you? You know, is everything okay? But then, honestly, I couldn't be bothered.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what do you do in that situation?
So you just let her cry?
I did, because I didn't want to, you know, maybe something had just happened, somebody had died, or maybe she was afraid to fly, or maybe she was sad about the in-flight movie? I don't know. No, go ahead.
So you ask a question as you're landing, because then you know you've got about 10 minutes of having to listen to her tops.
That's right.
And then you can feel good about yourself, but not actually have had to listen to her the whole
time. Wayne, what would you have done in that situation?
I want to start talking to her, because you can always take advantage of sympathy trim. You know what I'm saying? When they're upset, Reed, they're real easy.
Well, right.
Just so you know, a little compliment, a little dinner, you're in.
I know, but
you lost your husband.
She was dressed all in a suede sweatsuit, so I'm not quite sure she was. She would be down with.
Hey, you never know.
The man.
I think you should have started sobbing as well. Just unexplainable.
And then again, you could have just been like, you're not going to sob the whole damn ride, are you? You could have just ended it like that.
Nah, but then it gets awkward, and I mean, you can't go anywhere.
Well,
you're just
how
stuck
more in... awkward could it have been next for you? You're sitting next to a woman that's crying.
Right. Well,
there
I
should have been
know,
an end to it.
I just ignored. That was my tactic, to just pretend like nothing. It was a, you know, it's a 45-minute flight. I can deal with it.
Oh, 45 minutes. Yeah.
So you know,
what airline did you fly?
AirTran.
I love Air Tranny. Air Tranny. Hi, Daddy. Ready for your special meal, Daddy? So Reed was telling us, for some reason, Reed gets all these people that were on the Chappelle Show. We've had, who was the other dude?
Who was the other dude?
John Corbett.
Ah, yes. Right. Yes, a good friend of mine, indeed.
It was funny, but you're probably best known for, you were in the Real World parody, right, on
yeah,
the Chappelle Show. You were
the
token white guy.
I was the white guy in the house of black people.
And just so you know, Wayne's like the only human being on planet Earth that has never seen an episode.
Never seen it, really.
He doesn't have cable. He spends like
amazing.
300
on... First of all, it also sounds like something would be on UPN, and I don't even put that station on.
I mean, of course you haven't seen it. I mean,
UPN.
Look at his beard. He lives in a Viking boat. Of course he can't.
Exactly.
Of course he hasn't seen...
Oh, man.
All right.
But dude, that show has some seriously crazy fans. Though. You must have people just stop you on the street or like tap you on the shoulder at bar. Does it get weird?
It is bizarre because it's like people will recognize you, but they don't... There's no deference at all. So yeah. It's not like, hey, excuse me, sir. It's like, oh my God, you're that guy. And they'll like jump right in your face and they'll, you know, I generally get, I had sex with Katie too, or you stabbed my dad, or, you know, any variety of things. But there's no, excuse me, if you don't, like, you'll be in the middle of dinner. You'll be in the middle of like fighting with your girlfriend and like somebody will come up and just start like pointing at you and calling
you friends.
I hate
when that happens to me.
It what? Is often.
The wind. You know what I also read was pretty sweet is homeboy Christian Finnegan here has been name dropped twice on the post page six in like the last month.
What did
you get
do,
your name
dude?
In bold?
Huh?
You got your name in bold. Cindy
yeah.
Adams is giving you a mad shout out.
Well, yeah. It's the mysteries of PR work is what it is.
Oh, is that what happened?
Well, you know. Yeah, I'm sorry. I've got something in my throat. Oh. But yeah, you know, I do every once in a while on the Today Show, they'll bring in some people from Best Week Ever to banter about the week's pop culture events. Mm-hmm. And
what is Best Week Ever? I've never seen it.
Best Week Ever is like a pop culture wrap-up show on VH1. You know, it's Britney Spears had a baby. Let's make fun of her. You know, basically dumb stuff that's happening on TV and in pop culture, and you make fun of it, and you make fun of people with careers better than your own.
It started with, you remember the 70s, then it was remember the 80s, then it was remember the 90s, then it was remember last week, and now it's remember this week, because they want to keep making advertising revenue. Basically.
It's exactly right. Well, and the thing where you know, it's better than all the 70s, 80s, 90s is that those shows have to end at a certain point. This one never has to end.
It goes on forever.
On and on.
And ever.
On. Yes.
I love it.
So, yeah, we just banter, you know, just talk. I'm so worried about saying a naughty word now. I just can't get a word
it's
out
okay.
of my mouth.
Is the crucifix on the wall what makes you nervous?
There's a crucifix
the big,
on the
don't
wall?
You see it? The big crucifix on the wall with the midget on it.
I'm not very bright, Lazlow.
I don't know what I'm talking about.
Where's that Satanist?
By the way, Satanists listen to this show, just so you know.
Really?
Yeah, we had some hate mail from some Satanists because we made a couple jokes.
Really?
Right.
Yes.
Where was he from?
It was a she.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, she was like a total. Like, I'm totally into Satan, and I cut myself just so I can feel something, and like that kind of thing.
Right.
Like,
yeah, I think one night,
Satanet.
One night we cut the Ronnie James Dio, and there was a Lazlow got a couple emails.
Really?
No, yeah. I made a couple of jokes, and she got. A little
I
upset.
Love me some Dio.
Mm-hmm.
Dude, did you see that the National Guard is so desperate trying to lure people? In that they are now giving away iTunes songs. If you'll, I swear to God, if you go to the National Guard website right now and you sign up to be contacted by the Guard, you get 3 free downloads from iTunes.
Yeah,
I'd kill for that record.
Right. and that's a $3 value. You yes. just point out it's like not even.
Hey, if you go to Fallujah, you'll get this Sugar Ray song.
He's over there as a bullet.
Weirdly, if I got the Sugar Ray song, I'd want to go to Fallujah.
They do, and they do have a wonderful bowl of Jolly Ranchers in the enlistment office too. Which is,
Man, those people, it's hard times over there.
And I'm sorry, it was just very funny that that was your sort of ending. And really, got to remember the troops.
Right. I don't mean that. I just mean, I mean, it's hard times for the recruiters.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we have a lot of Marines, actually, that listen to the show, including a guy from Australia who...
somehow found his way into the American military, which we can't quite figure out.
Right, and so he ran around in his Humvee.
We're looking for insurgents!
And Matt the Marine, big fan of the show. In fact, he misses parts of the show when we make fun of him, and then he goes and downloads them to find out what we said about him.
He's just a regular insultee of the show?
I don't know. Somehow he's defended our country, so we're tearing him up. I don't really know how it works. The other thing, Reed, I wanted to bring up is the big gay bill got vetoed by Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Oh, did it?
It finally happened.
Well, I think the first problem is that they called it the big gay bill. I mean, generally speaking, that never works.
Sounds like an episode of South Park. Nobody's going to vote for that. Yeah, no, I didn't read that. I've been behind on
it
my...
It finally happened.
So what was his rationale, did he say?
Well, I always thought it was weird that a guy who has admitted to having three ways...
Without a doubt.
Yeah, exactly. That's you're in a position to judge what's natural and not at that point. But sorry, I got serious there.
I know. Reed called me this week and he goes, "Dude, I just got off a phone sex line. What was that?"
Reed.
Yeah, it wasn't.
He just finished up and he thought I would be the next one for a little poke, you know, a little post coital.
Either that or his credit card ran out and he tried to finish up with you.
Hey, you were kind of breathing heavy, fool.
We can talk about this more next week, but it was you know, we might have somebody from the timeout sex issue on next week, and it was a part of that. But I'm telling you, this girl, called this girl, her name was Daisy. Now guess how you spell Daisy.
God, I'm not even gonna go there.
It was not D-A-I-S-Y. It was like D-A-Y silent H-Z-E-E or something. It was like
she was like,
as long as you believe it was a girl on the other hand, you're in good shape.
Have they outsourced phone sex to the Philippines? What happened?
No, I don't know. She said she was in Las Vegas, and
of course
I sort of believed her. Actually, she said, I asked her, you know, I was like, oh, come on, you know, you must make stuff up. Like, you're sitting there, you say you're wearing lingerie, but you're really wearing like sweatpants and, you know, a sweatshirt, something unsexy. And she's like, no, you know, I'm kind of, I guess you would call it slow. And so I can't really make nothing up. I just have to say what I see. You know, honestly, I believe
that. I gotta say, Reed, I love your female character voice.
I know, boy.
That has got a future.
My pants are feeling kind of tight.
Yes.
Maybe it was a dude, you know? It was
I'm a homosexual!
No.
Okay, so now I call a female phone sex line, and now I'm a homosexual. What exactly, what part of that makes me a homosexual?
Reed, there are many paths to the waterfall.
Right, exactly. Right. So this woman had a lot of interesting stories that we can't really... talk but about here.
Did you use the service to your advantage?
I did not, no.
So
he was writing an
article. It was more of an interview.
He was writing an article, so somewhere on his like expense sheet, it's going to be like $89.
I love that. When that email came that said you're free to expense your phone sex charge, I've been waiting 32 years for that. It was sweet.
By the way, Wayne, you froze my goddamn Diet Dr. Pepper. And
I
it's
told
like
you to keep it away from the board.
It's frozen solid. The idea is to drink it. It's not a slush.
You know what? When you take the cap off, you put your lips on it and suck.
Boy, if I had a dollar.
So you do get like lots of the Chappelle Show hoo-ha there.
Generally speaking, if people recognize me and all, you know, and it's like I'm basically on the level of, you know, I don't know, somebody who got kicked off Survivor on week one. You know, it's not, we're not talking about a lot of people here, you know, but generally like college kids, like when I go to colleges and perform, like dudes will recognize me from Chappelle Show and girls will recognize me from Best Week Ever. And that's just how I roll, Laszlo.
It's kind of.
I'm very cool. I don't know if you're picking up in the subtext here. What I'm trying to tell you is I rule, and my career is amazing.
Oh, without a doubt. But it's got to kind of blow that you're on a highly rated show, And the guy walks off and goes to Africa. And, well, and there's nothing more said about it than he's in Africa. He's got a drug problem. He's got a visa problem.
Well, it kind of worked out for me. I was only on one sketch. It just happens to be a very popular sketch because, you know, it's very well written and it's very funny. I was only on that one thing. So in a way, the fact that there are only two seasons of it works to my advantage because who knows whether they would have ever brought me back to do anything. So now I'm like...
They're not bringing him back to do anything, so don't worry about it.
Oh, trust me. If he could come back now, he's, you know, Comedy Central is like the housewife, you know, like, no, he really loves me. And, you know, he could come back right now and say, I want to do a show, and they'd kiss his ass and, you know.
Reed, just so you know, yesterday I was on hanging out on the beach with a certain girl in a bikini who has a little crush on you.
Who is this?
Yeah.
It would be Wayne's girl.
My girl, dude.
Yeah.
It was just me and her. I was fishing.
She confided in you?
Yeah, she did. She said she loves the Reed character in the show.
The Reed character.
The Reed character in the show. Because she doesn't
know. You know, the homosexual character.
She doesn't know any more than you than the character.
Right, the guy who plays straight.
I'm trying to get
straight.
You out. The guy who plays straight. Okay. But he's really gay.
He tries
Man.
To pretend to
you
be.
You know, don't burst the bubble. Keep... I'm not like this in real life. This is a character.
No, I'm looking to get you out there one day, so right. You know it might work for me. You know, right. If she sees you, I might get
but
a better time.
Here's the bizarre part.
I mean, it works like that for her. If you know what I'm saying.
Does she have a pillow named Reed?
Yeah, she don't need a pillow. She's got Big Wayne.
I didn't know where that was going. I was really scared.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah. It didn't even involve you. It involved me.
Really?
I'm scared too.
So, don't be
well,
scared.
No, that's
it's
good.
All good.
I'm very flattered.
You know, because then maybe there could be a little swap thing going on.
Oh, I knew the swinging was coming.
Suburbanites.
Right. It's going to be Wayne and Yoko Ono.
Right. I trade Boy George for your wife. You know. Yeah.
I'm
sure.
A homosexual.
I was wondering what the bowl of car keys in the middle of the counter was.
By the way, after the show at Fridays, we swing.
Wow.
Yeah, whoever is able to sort of take it the most
and
gets some free
is that
jalapeno
how you got that
poppers.
Scar on your back?
Get some free jalapeno poppers.
Gets a free draft at TGI Fridays in Penn Station.
And from all that swapping, is that how you got that scar on your back?
No, I got the scar on my back from falling out of bed drunk and hitting the nightstand. After Wayne was in the parking lot of this benefit chasing a woman in a wheelchair scooter screaming he's going to grab her ass. And so I had to go home
right.
And
where do you go from there? I'm not sure.
We should mention that Wayne has a slight fetish for any woman that's disabled in some way. Is that fair,
yes,
Wayne?
That's true.
Really?
Yeah.
Physically or mentally or both?
Both. I have a soft side for him.
Really?
Turns hard. But
you have a soft side for women with the soft side? I don't know.
No, just like handicaps, you know? Missing limbs.
Romantic moments with Big Wayne.
It's all good.
Well, I'll see what I can.
Someone's got to love them.
that is true. That is an untapped market. You are the Donnie Deutsch of our generation,
dude. I was reading this article in the New York Times about stuff that people leave on the Long Island Railroad, and the person was going through, and of course, there's the iPods and the books. Prosthetic leg.
Whoopsie.
Yeah.
You gotta,
you
that's gonna be
that?
You wake up in Babylon, you look down, you're like, dude, I know I was at Fridays, there was some swinging, and then my leg's gone.
It was a hot day, I took it off.
So you can tell what kind of person, personality they have by the music that they listen to.
Oh, yeah, because it went so well 20 minutes ago. What's,
No,
I appreciate it.
We're going to give you another shot.
Are you going to give me another shot?
We're going to give you another shot. I was listening to this song this week. Okay. It's, sometimes I try to get into some indigenous music. This is actually a Native American group that I was listening to.
And he's not lying about this.
I was in the studio. Listen to the... I want you to listen to the lyrics. It's only about 20 seconds, but Native Americans are coming correct with trying to be part of pop culture now, so they're sort of doing cover songs.
This is a cover? Sound off. Oh, okay. That's really awful.
Why a bunch of Native Americans, stopped drinking for a moment and decided to cover a tune The SpongeBob SquarePants song.
Who is that going to appeal to?
Well, that is, you know, I don't know if you know that is a part of the sacred history, and I think it's actually very insulting that you're making fun of this.
What?
They've been singing that song for hundreds of years.
Right.
Just because you're not culturally sensitive enough to. Right.
Only to have this cartoon come along and rip them off.
I thought I saw Squidward in some of the cave paintings.
It was actually, you know, He Who Runs with Square Pants was the actual Native American name back in the day. I think I could tell you what you'd be saying about yourself, but I'm not. I don't know if I can say it on the air.
Really?
Yeah, you might need to.
Well, give it a shot.
Because Lazlow got into college by saying he was 1/8 Cherokee. It's all good.
No, I. Okay, it's a bad word though. No.
Oh,
now
yeah,
I built it up. No.
No, come on, let it fly.
No,
no,
don't really.
Please.
There's some dissension.
Do you want to write it down, maybe, and we'll review it.
Basically, you know. I'm allergic to women, is basically what you're saying, if you like that song.
Uh-huh.
This is awful.
You know something? You hit him right on the head.
Awful.
You hit him right on the head. He does hate
Never
women.
Ask me to do anything prepared again.
What,
okay?
Prepared?
Because, well, I mean, never set me up to be like, okay, this is going to be funny, because then it will be awful.
I didn't say it was going
to
be funny.
And then you will stare at me. Lazlow, you have death in your eyes. If you people listening to the radio could see the death that stares across from me when I try to make a joke, and he just looks at me like I just punched his mother in the throat.
It's not death, it's a thyroid problem.
Yeah, my eyes bulge.
That's a
little bit. No, I just get, you know, you were in the room for 5 minutes, I'm hitting the dump button. Wayne has been stealing somebody's Red Bulls in the green room over there and is pretty jacked up. He's cursed a couple of times. It's a whole new world order now. We're supposed to be reading from Deuteronomy right now and then, you know, playing some Hole.
And the sky was made of
93 K-Rock, it is the Lazlow Show, episode 12, playing a record amount of no music this show. Are you down, Reed?
I guess I'm down, yeah.
Unless you're counting Asian rap, in which case.
Right, which is a record amount of, yeah.
And Christian Finnegan, comedian, you said you're doing some stand-up like next week or something?
I'd play all over the city. I have, you know, I'm playing stand-up New York this Friday night, two shows, 9 and 11, if anybody wants to come out for that. And I play around the country and do stuff like that. If anybody wants to check out my website, it's just christianfinnegan.com. Amazing, huh? Pretty sweet name.
Yeah. I'm Lazlow.com. And Wayne, I tried to register bigwayne.com, but I was
an entirely different kind of site.
But
taken by a trucking company or something.
I don't know what it was.
Right. It was actually Large Marge from Pee Wee Herman had registered it. ReedTucker.com was available, so it is now hosting inappropriate content. I have your address as the registrant, and they shall be showing up over there. It's actually...
He's on some sort of FBI watch list?
No, it's actually underage girls riding mopeds.
Yeah, Lazlow bought my name, and now he holds it over my head.
Like,
but, you know, I don't care. I don't have anything to put on a website. What am I going to put up there?
I don't know. Something. That's the new thing. Everybody's got to have a website.
I don't care. Nobody cares about my life. I'm not going to have a blog or anything like that.
Do you have a blog?
No. Why? What did you hear?
I don't know. It's just if people are like, you need a blog. It's like, what? So I can sit there and have some kind of witty essay about politics? No.
I used to write all the time, and now it's like once every 3 months I, you know, put something up there. But yeah, it's technically does exist on the website, but I never... really say anything on it.
I was at this that tech thing I was telling you about where they're showing all the big stuff coming out for the holidays. You know, people are not using phones anymore. They're using their mobiles, so they're getting rid of their landlines. And that also means that people are buying less cordless phones for the house. So to compete, the cordless phone companies are doing their best to come out with all sorts of amazing things that your cordless phone will do.
This is the i5871 cordless telephone system. It's 5.8 gigahertz. It has a 65K color LCD screen. You can do downloadable ringtones. You can do...
Ringtones on my cordless phone.
Yes, ringtones on your cordless phone. You can do pictures on there. So, like, if your mom calls, your picture of your mom will pop up. You can sync it with your Outlook or your Palm. Price is $199.
I've always wanted to sync my Outlook or Palm to a cordless phone.
Yeah, it's actually, yeah. So it's basically a cell phone that you can't take out of your house. That's exactly what you just described. There's nothing about that.
I love talking to these PR chicks at these events. because they, and it's not always PR chicks, I'm sorry, sometimes it's PR dudes, but I went up to this one, you know, everybody's got these wireless routers now, so they can have wireless internet access in their house, and this one booth was showing off these big antennas that you can hook to your wireless router, so you can go like way down the block and sit out in front of somebody's house and still be on your, you know, internet connection. So I totally stumped this chick.
Because it ships with a 5 dBi antenna, so you want to increase the range because you can't get in, let's say, the backyard right now. So by swapping out the antenna, you're getting increased range.
Can you just use aluminum foil?
Stumped her.
Ouch.
Stumped her.
I love her. As soon as she has to go off script, she doesn't know what to do. She's just frozen.
She's kind of like the president.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Honestly, I don't know.
It's your product. I'm like, can you just put aluminum foil in the antenna? And she's like, dude, she looked like deer in the headlights.
9/11.
What was that about?
What?
You hate the troops? What was that about? What was that on 9/11?
Dude, somebody's already going to come and get me for what you put up on my website, apparently. I don't need any more trouble from the man.
Enjoy France, commie.
Okay, so I've solved a big problem. I am full of caffeine at the moment, so... And how many Red Bulls are you into now?
I'm three deep, and my...
Try talking on the microphone.
I'm three deep!
God damn.
What did you say?
I said, God damn, Wayne. I was looking at this story about fan fiction. You know, people that are really into a comic book or a movie will write fan fiction, stories that are a continuation of... the series, if the series is gone, or even if the series is still going on or the movies are still going on, maybe they write some fan fiction for...
Star Trek.
Star Trek is a big one.
And Doctor Who.
Doctor Who. Yeah. Well, there's fan fiction on the internet. People are writing stories for Buffy the Vampire Slayer. There's 27,000 stories people have posted online. The Matrix, yes. Of course. Schindler's List.
You know what? That is actually kind of awesome. Like that somebody would watch that movie and be like, I feel like there's some untold stories here.
There's 6 million of them.
Oh, jeez. Egads, yes.
Yeah.
Guy.
From every mountainside.
That's our racist alarm.
Or
see,
just general
I'm an
inappropriate.
Equal opportunity racist, though. I pick them all.
That's true.
And so people have been writing fan fiction and posting it on the internet for The Breakfast Club.
Mm-hmm.
Right? As well as Reba. What's Reba?
That's
Reba,
a country show.
Reba McEntire's sitcom.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me?
How much free time do you actually need? Like, what's going on in your life? Like, what sort of broken leg, you know, like, how laid up in bed in front of the laptop are you before you're like, you know what? I think it's time.
I gotta tell you this.
It's time to commit these ideas to paper.
But some of my favorites here, people have evidently been writing a fan fiction, continuing the epic tale of the Smurfs. Some of the titles are Smurfs That Live Inside My Brain, The Communist Smurf.
It's a good one.
Mm-hmm. Which I'm pretty sure they were all communists. I mean, they were.
Yeah,
they certainly shared Smurfette.
Helping each other out.
Oh, Smurfette was a big thing. And of course, Gaylord mentioned to me one time when we were hanging out that he found it disturbing that there was a big bunch of guys and one girl.
Yeah, well, didn't you?
No, I thought it was hot. I wanted to see, like, the untold...
They're always gang-smurfing her.
Right. And see, that was what I was thinking, is maybe we should start using Smurf on the air, because we can't say anything else in this, you know, crazy post-Janet Jackson planet. We have to say, you know, like, I'm going to Smurf the hell out of you.
Smurf off.
Yeah. Smurf off. But some of the other fan fiction that people have written, the Smurfette Village... Which is evidently loads of... I'm gonna smurf that blue ass. And then, of course, Return to the Smurfette Village, because I guess it was sort of like, you know, in porn.
It was very exciting first time, and 20 minutes later, I wanted to go back.
Went to the other village and said, guys, there's a whole village of blue hoes right over the next valley. And one that's still in progress, fan fiction, people writing for Smurfs, How Things Smurf, which follows Hefty Smurf on an epic journey that spans several centuries.
Several centuries.
Hefty yes. Smurf.
Right. Did you watch the Smurfs? Did they have that in England?
They did. I don't remember Hefty Smurf. I remember the one with the glasses.
Hefty Smurf was like the like brawny one, right? I think he was the dude Smurf. Who like... Was he fat? I don't know. You'd think so, Hefty. But I think he was like muscly.
Okay.
And there's also people have been writing fan fiction stories for Alf. I was really hoping that he would go away. That was probably the worst part of the 80s. Had to be the Alf section. People are writing stories like Alf meets William Hung.
is anybody actually writing that? Or is
I swear
that just,
these are
there's
all,
actually a story behind it.
Yes. They've written a story where I guess Alf's spaceship or something, and he eats a cat. Or he and William Hung are eating a cat together at an Asian restaurant or something.
I'm guessing there were bong hits involved yeah. in the creation of
are
that
these
story.
People hoping to be
deserved a racial alarm.
No, when you talk to me,
I am Kia. That doesn't deserve the racial alarm.
No.
You're an Asian joke.
No, it doesn't, that's because I run the board and I decide what's inappropriate. And
but
what's
do you guys think that these people are posting this fan fiction hoping to get discovered in some way? You know, you ever go to karaoke and there's somebody who's like way, way too into it and has on like a nice sequin dress and it thinks that like
I mean I don't know. Nobody writing the Alf fan fiction probably thinks that way. But I guarantee you the people who write like the Anne Rice fan fiction or the, you know, Harry Potter, I actually read sadomasochistic erotic Harry Potter fan fiction once on the web.
That's
which was
hot.
Like Harry Potter and Ron Weasley like tied to some rack and being tortured sexually. It was
I know. Love it.
And you know where I read it? On my computer.
Yeah. He was sitting there typing, and yeah. then...
I can't believe this exists. Type.
another Alf fan fiction story was the Alf Family Matters Mork and Mindy crossover.
Mm.
Big fun. And Alf and Urkel visit Planet Ork.
That's just going to be a licensing nightmare if that ever gets made. You know, you're going to have to get all the parties together and just try to... Can't get those people on the same page.
Mm-mm. I love it. Dude, we have about 800 things that we just never even got to. We should just say that next week on the show, it's going to be a full reunion. We did on the first show that we did, you thought today was bad with the dump button. The first show, one of the guys sitting exactly in the seat that you're sitting in mm-hmm. was called by his boss in the first hour and told to never do this show again.
Really?
Yeah.
Who was the guy?
And they disappeared him. He's like on a cargo jet to Fallujah.
is he a comic? Or?
No, he works for a major New York sports team. And,
can't say. Oh. And they didn't like to have that team associated with that sort of show.
Tell me what the person's name rhymes with?
What his name rhymes with?
Palix.
Right. So you just said his name with a P.
Well, I didn't.
Palix.
It rhymes.
It right. does.
You America. Gave it away.
Anyway, it's going to be the full reunion show. Next week, it's Cousin Ed is coming back.
Good.
Alex is coming. I'm just going to say it because that sports team can go screw themselves. I'm tired of, you know.
Smurf themselves.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can kiss my Smurf.
Yes.
And Smurf my Smurf.
Ooh.
Sounds
Smurfy.
So, I'm feeling kind of Smurfy.
Mm.
Dude, hurry, grab my Smurf.
Oh, that's a little tiny Smurf.
Wait, you're talking about... Oh.
right.
So, next week is episode 13. Supposedly Cousin Ed and Jimmy and Appropriate are coming, and I'm trying to get that dude Sweaty Steve. I had audio from that guy Sweaty Steve.
These guys, their names already, I don't want them here. Jimmy and Appropriate and Sweaty Steve.
We didn't even tell you about our friend Chemical Chris.
Yeah, you guys would never guess you're on a radio show. Like, these are such radio show names. Like, yeah. Sweaty Steve.
You know, all these guys, these are all... like non-real radio people. I mean, they're just dudes. Sweaty Steve's been called Sweaty Steve for years. Chemical Chris is the guy that gives Wayne pills.
Yeah.
Well, what did you take last night?
I can't even remember. Wasn't a Percocet?
It was a Xanax.
Xanax, that's it. Says, oh, you take one of these, sleep for 24 hours. Only take half. So I slept for 14.
Wow.
Is this guy a Mexican pharmacist?
No.
Where is this guy?
He's actually a carpenter, too.
Oh, he is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you know you can trust your carpenter friends. And Chemical Chris has got a couple good stories that we need to get on the air.
Yeah, we all definitely right. need
one
to
one is this past weekend. He was down to the West End for the big Irish Day Parade.
Yeah, now,
if you notice,
Beach.
It's nowhere near St. Paddy's Day, but they got their own parade.
Sure.
Especially just a bunch of drunks. Well, he was down there making out with fat chicks.
Yeah. And, like, this is a good-looking guy that is... is like, you know, built and gets like hot chicks. And like as a joke, he's just making out with fat chicks, and dudes just, are offering these fat chicks $50 if they will pleasure him.
Put his junk.
One of them took him up on it until her fat friends C-blocked him.
Smurf blocked him.
Smurf blocked him. I was just about to smurf.
Boy, you know, the only thing that make that hotter is if they were disabled, right, Wayne?
Down.
Yeah.
So the. Every episode of the show is available at the website. It's lazlow.com. Drew Curtis of FARC.com had a delayed flight. He's on CNN tomorrow. But he said he's going to come on our show live in a couple weeks. He said he was going to fly in just for us.
Is that right?
Yeah, and maybe do CNN again. But
right. I was going to say, we don't have that kind of budget.
sitting in for Reed on this episode for a couple of hours and then hanging out was comedian... well, you know, you sent me your bio, Gaylord. It says comedian, homophobe, and neurotic.
It didn't say that.
It's what you emailed.
Neurotic,
me.
It said.
Neurotic? Or yeah. Erotic?
Not erotic. That was the other bit of spam you got.
Au contraire, my friend. You're very erotic.
Isn't he? Dude, with a name like Gaylord, don't you think that's
trapped in a room full of fat men? The Smurfs. It's come back to haunt me.
Comedian Christian Finnegan, which has a, you've got a website, ChristianFinnegan.com.
That's right, Finnegan.
And you're on VH1's what?
VH1's Best Week Ever, Fridays at 11, and then all weekend they play like six times over the course of the weekend. And then also Game Time on TV Land Monday nights.
Ooh, Game Time, what's that?
It's like an interstitial game show. It's like kind of like, you know how they do dinner in a movie where it's they'll have 3 minutes of show and then they'll go to something and then they'll come back later. It's kind of like that, except it's goofy sort of TV related games. But it's a lot of fun, and if you love Andy Griffith reruns, this is the show for you, my friend.
Wow, TV's gotten really segmented. There's gonna be like a channel and just for you, like this is Bob's channel 158. It's for Bob at 315 Pine Street.
Just all programming geared towards that dude.
Yeah. Well, you know, they're talking about, and they've got it in the works, that they're going to start sending commercials to different houses based on your demographics. So you're both watching the same show, but you each watch different commercials.
Hmm. There's probably some hilarious joke in there. Unfortunately, I'm not fast enough to find it.
No, it's scary. No. It's what it is. Spooky.
Every hack comic in the world will be doing this as a bit.
So you're kind of saying
happening.
If I'm home watching BET... They're going to give me an Anheuser-Busch commercial, and the other guy who's up the block, who's African-American, they're going to give him a different commercial, like a Miller Lite commercial.
Damn! 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 Dude, Chuck D alarm. Chuck D's very upset.
Did you take it as that?
Just called you out.
I was... Thought you were dancing around it slightly.
Dancing? Plowed right into it. It's like a Top Gun episode.
But I think if you're going to say it, you got to say it, dude.
Hey, you're going to go big, you got to go big.
So this has been the Lazlow Show, or what's left of it. We've hit the dump button four times, which is new world record. Like I said, the website's lazlow.com, and we've now upgraded our bandwidth plan so that people in Uruguay, and I even got an email from Scotland, and... I don't know what they do over there. Every guy I've met from Scotland's a bit disturbing. Gaylord and I have a friend that's from Scotland.
Craig.
Yeah.
Yeah, we love Craig.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
You had a good time in a bar with him, didn't you, in L.A.?
Yes, I did. I also had a good time. I cannot party with people from England, Scotland, because you're all junkies.
Thanks, lads.
Tear me to pieces.